وَإِن تَعْجَبْ فَعَجَبٌ قَوْلُهُمْ أَإِذَا كُنَّا تُرَابًا أَإِنَّا لَفِي خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ أُولَئِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَأُولَئِكَ الْأَغْلَالُ فِي أَعْنَاقِهِمْ وَأُولَئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أستاذ عبد الرحمن حسن السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته
بارك الله فيكم for joining me once again on the Hot Seat podcast
Jazakallah khairan for having me.
As we often do, I want to get straight into the topic inshallah. And today we're actually going to be talking about the issue of music and whether music is permissible or not in the religion of Islam. And as always, I'm going to give you the opportunity to start with your introduction.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى Before I go into the ruling of music and what it is in our Sharia I think it's very important that we first of all understand what these terms are or else what's going to happen is khalt, confusion. You're going to be talking about something, I'm going to be talking about something.
Okay.
And they might come out from there. Yani when we don't have the same thing in mind and we're given yani two different rulings in order to come together is that we first of all agree on these definitions, these okay. terms, and then we make our way.
Cool.
So I've looked into the books of the ulama, what they've said about al-ghina, for example, that's the term. Al-ghina means singing. Al-ghina, the ulama, when I looked at their categorization or their definition of the word, I found that their categorization revolves around three. Okay? And you can find it in the kitab Kafur Ri'ah by Ibn Hajar al-Haytami. And also Talbisu Iblis by Ibn al-Jawzi and also Majmu' al-Fatawa by Ibn Taymiyyah and Ithafu Sadat al-Muttaqin by Az-Zabidi. Those great scholars have mentioned يعني, the types I'm going to be mentioning inshallah ta'ala.
Okay,
and these types are of course كَمَا دَلَّتَ عَلَيْهِ الْأَدِلَّةُ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ The Qur'an has shown it and the Sunnah and also the istilahu al-ulama this usage of the scholars يعني أهل اللغة Ahlul Fiqh, and other than them, inshallah ta'ala. So, the first categorization is al-ghina, which is mubah.
Okay, which
so
means?
There's a type of singing which is permissible. And that is that which is just mujarrad raf'u sawt, just raising the voice with poetry, for example, or other than poetry. And there's recitation to it. And it's not done in a way where يعني, it has. You know, when people sing, singers, professional singers, they have, يعني, it's a science for them. So they have rhythms, they follow
like a tone, and
a tone, okay. Pronunciation, articulation. It's none of that.
Okay, fine.
It's just مجرد الترتيل and maybe a ترجيع, which is معتدل. It doesn't go outside the natural form of the person. It's not something you need to study or learn. And this is generally used, according to the early Arabs, when there was عمل شاق, a hard يعني labor, work they were doing, they would say these words.
Mm.
Or if they were carrying anything heavy or they were traveling a far distance in order to make things easy for themselves. And it's called, according to the Arabs, Huda'il A'rab. Okay, bi'ibilihim. They do it for their camels when they يعني, sing for the... Also, women sing it for their children.
Okay.
It's called Ghina'u Nisa'i li taskini sigarihinna. Women are singing just to, you know, calm their children down. For example, Rockabye Baby,
yeah.
For example, may fall under this one. Okay. And I think every culture has something similar to this. And also the slave girls back in those times singing to one another. Also, يعني poetry and all of this falls under this form.
But there's no melody to it. Is that right? Or is there, can there be a little melody to it? Like, what do you mean?
See, these terms are a bit like general terms. So when you say are there melody to it? يعني, it's like recitation of the Qur'an. Is there melody to it?
Yeah, to a certain extent.
Yeah, so then that's the level of it. Okay. It's mubah this type. We have. There's no issue on this one. And this is part of the sunan of the Arabs. Arabs were like this. This is not something new for them. The way that the Arabs were in terms of how their personality and their singing was. And Imam al-Shatibi mentions in his i'tisam, he says, وَالْعَرَبُ لَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُمْ مِنْ تَحْسِينِ النَّغَمَاتِ مَا يَجْرِي مَجْرَى مَا النَّاسُ عَلَيْهِ الْيَوْمَ. The way that the people are today when it comes to singing, the Arabs before were not like that, he says. بَلْ كَانُوا يُنْشِدُونَ الشِّعْرَ مُطَلَّقًا. They used to just sing and they used to say those words, مِنْ غَيْرِ أَنْ يَتَعَلَّمُوا هَذِهِ تَرْجِيعَاتِ, without having to study these rhythms, التي حدثت بعدهم, which came after. So they used to just say as it is. And then he mentions the example of Abdullah ibn Rawaha, the companion, when he was doing it in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Ansar were saying it when they were also building the trench. نَحْنُ الَّذِينَ بَايَعُوا مُحَمَّدًا عَلَى الْجِهَادِ مَا بَقِينَ أَبَدًا, like that.
Right, okay, fine.
And then they will respond to each other by saying, Allahumma la aisha illa aishul akhira, faghfir lil ansari wal muhajira. These type of statements, Shatibi says. Okay. So this type is permissible. It is from the ghina, the singing, which is mubah.
Fine.
Walidhalika, the hadith, inshallah ta'ala, of our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, where the two slave girls were singing, it's mentioned that Ibn al-Jawzi mentions in his Talbis Iblis that Ja'far ibn Muhammad, and he said, قلت لي أبي عبد الله, I said to Imam Ahmed, I said to him about the hadith of Aisha, and Aisha tahiwanin yughannina, aish hadha al-ghina. What were these two women who were singing in front of our mother Aisha? What were they? And then he said, ghina'u al-rakibi. It's the singing of the rider. And he mentioned what they were like saying, ataynakum, ataynakum. Khalal mentioned in his kitab, al-amr bil-ma'ruf wa nahy anil-munkar. Ibn al-Jawzi mentions in his kitab, talbisu iblis. So that's the type we're talking about here, which is mubah. Also, Ibn Athir commented on that same hadith of our mother Aisha, hadith al-jariyatayn, latayni, which kanata tughanniyani la'aisha, that were singing for Aisha. He said, ay tunshidani al-ash'ar. They were reading poetry, allati qilat yawma bu'athin, which was said on the day of bu'ath. And this is called wasummiya dhalika. Ibn Athir's kitab, al-nihaya, في غريب الحديث, it's in the words which are strange. So he's trying to explain to what the word ghina means. He says, أي تنشدان الأشعار. Here in this hadith, it means that they were reading poetry, which was said on the day of Bu'atha. وسمي ذلك غناء لنوع يثبت فيه الإنشاد والترجيع, he says. ولكن لم يكن يسمون ذلك مغنيا إلا من يحسن الغناء ويتعاطاه. لذلك استدركت عائشة قولها بعبارة ليستا مغنيتين. These people, women were just singing. And this type that we mentioned, Ibn Hajar mentioned in Fathul Bari, rahimahullah, explaining the hadith of Jariyatayn. He said, الغناء يطلق على رفع الصوت وعلى الترنم وعلى الحداء ولا يسمى فاعله مغنيا وإنما سمي ذلك. He said, وإنما سمي بذلك, sorry, من ينشد بتمطيط وتكسير وتهييج وتسويق فيما فيه تعريض الفواحش أو تصريحه.
A summary of what he says? Or?
It means just they were rough assault, raising their voices, maybe beautifying it. And he mentions like a huda. Huda, again, it's the term that's going to keep coming back. It's referring to the way that they used to sing for their camels. And if you go on YouTube, you can see it, Arabs, how they sang for their camels. And the camel, when it's done, it starts moving. It starts. Okay. It's like, also, when they do it amongst themselves, they're carrying heavy things and they do it together. This also helps them.
A form of motivation, keep the morale high.
Keep them
like
high. Naam.
Okay.
Also, Qadi Iyad mentions it, rahimahullah ta'ala, which is, he mentions it, his statement, Suyuti mentions it in his kitab, Al-Dibaj. He says, Kana ghina uma, these two women who were with Aisha, their singing was, Bima huwa min ash'ari al-Arab, it was the poetry of the Arabs, wal mufakharati wal shaja'ati wal dhuhuri wal ghalabati, wa hadha la yuhayyiju al jawari ala sharrin wala ifsadin. Same. Suyuti himself mentions it in his Zahri al-Ruba. Munawi, Abdul Ra'uf al-Munawi, mentions it in his Hashiyat al-Mujtaba. He says, Tughanniyani ay tarfa'ani aswatahuma. They were just raising their voices. Okay, bi inshadi al-shi'ri, huwa qareemun min al-huda. It was like a huda. Okay. Also, Ibn Abd al-Barr rahimahullah mentions a very powerful point. He says, وَهَذَا الْبَابُ مِنَ الْغِنَىٰ الَّذِي أَجَازَهُ الْعُلَمَىٰ وَوَرَدَتِ الْآثَارُ عَنِ السَّلَفِ بِإِجَازَتِهِ. You see, وَهُوَ يُسَمَّى غِنَاءَ الرُّكْبَانِ وَغِنَاءُ النَّصَبِ وَالْحُدَاءِ هَذِهِ الْأَوْجُهُ مِنَ الْغِنَاءِ لَا خِلَافَ فِي جَوَازِهَا بَيْنَ الْعُلَمَىٰ. So this type, it is, يعني, the scholars have all allowed it.
Fine, okay. There's no dispute amongst the scholars.
And the Salaf, many of them, they've said it. It's called sometimes غِنَاء الرُّكُبَانِ. It's called غِنَاء النَّصَبِ. It's also called حُدَى. And this type, which I just explained now, this one he says, لَا خِلَافَ فِي جَوَازِهَا بَيْنَ الْعُلَمَىٰ. There's no dispute amongst the scholars regarding this.
Okay. What's the second? Sorry.
And before I go into the second one, it comes in many forms, many athar that have shown it. For example, غناء الجواري في أيام عيد, the hadith of Aisha, which was on the day of Eid. So the day of Eid, these two women were singing in front of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Abu Bakr basically rejected their action, and then he said to them, أبي مزمار الشيطان, أبي مزمار الشيطان عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said to them, are you going to play the mizmar of Shaytan in the presence of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام? And then the Prophet told him, he told him that this is allowed, it's Yawm al-Eid. Okay, by the way, the word mizmar is used as beautifying your voice.
Okay.
It's not referred to as music all the time. Like when Dawood عليه السلام, Allah mentioned, the Prophet mentioned in the Hadith Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet said, لَقَدْ أُوْتِيْتَ مِزْمَارًا مِنْ مَزَامِيرِ آلِ دَاوُدْ. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, you've been given مِزْمَارًا مِنْ مَزَامِيرِ آلِ دَاوُدْ. And Imam al-Nawwi mentions, المراد بالمزمار, he says, it means صوت الحسن. وأصم الأصل المزمار, he said, it means الغنى, it's to sing. وآل داود هو داود نفسه. This is referring to داود. The same العراقي, he says, in طرح التثريب. He says, والمراد بالمزمار, it means beautifying your voice. The same thing Ibn Hajar mentions in فتح الباري, he says, والمراد بالمزمار الصوت الحسن. So when he said to him, for example, Abu Bakr said to Aisha, are you going to be playing Mizmar al-Shaytan عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم? He meant the beautification of the voice, of course. But the Prophet corrected Abu Bakr and told him, no, this is the ghina which is mubah.
Okay, I have some more questions on that hadith, and I'm sure we're going to tackle them later.
Inshallah ta'ala. The second one is ghina al-jawari fil urs. يعني, the jawari are singing on the day of, Eid, like the day of Eid.
So this is the second type.
Yeah, within the first part type, which is mubah.
Within the first type, okay.
The mubah type. The second type is غِنَاءُ الْجَوَارِ فِي الْعُرْسِ. يعني the jawari, the slave girls, are singing on the day of wedding. This is found in Bukhari, من حديث ربيع بنت معوذ. She said, فَجَعَلَتْ جُوَيْرَاتٍ يَضْرِبْنَ بِالدُّفِّ. There were slave girls who were hitting the duff. And they were talking about, of course, their fathers on the day of Badr. مبارك فوري رحمه الله إن تحفة الأحوذي, he says, وهي ذكر أوصاف الميت بالثناء عليه وتعدد محاسن بالكرم والشجاعة ونحوها. That's all they were chanting. They were talking about their dead and what they praising them and stuff like that. The third one is غناء السفر ومنه الحداء والنصب. I mentioned that already. And حداء ابن الجوزي mentions it in his تلبيس إبليس. He says, وهذا يحرك الإبل والآدمي. Something that you say that moves a person. Of course, there's no, يعني it's not outside the norms of a person. And of course, it's the famous one Ibn al-Qudama mentions in his Mughni, Abdullah ibn al-Rawaha was doing, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to him, رويدك رفقا بالقوارير, يعني easy, Abdullah, رفقا بالقوارير, يعني رفقا بالنساء, be simple with the women, because it was getting. The fourth type within the first type that's permissible is غناء وتش تنشيط على الأعمال الشاقة. I already mentioned it. People are building houses, they're building something, and they just want something to, يعني, this is a type, it's the same type, which is singing. They sing in order to get the work done. And it's the one I mentioned, the Sahabas were saying, Allahumma la aisha illa aishul akhira faghfir lil ansar wal muhajira. Like that. And also a fifth type, which is ghina'ul ghuzati, wa shuja'ani wal fursan, horsemen fighting in the battlefield, and things like that. All of which is basically legislation, evidences have come regarding it, and it's all the first type. The second type,
so just to summarize the first type, then this is the permissible type, and this is a type where it's just like your voice is raised, and it doesn't go out of any kind of natural voice or rhythm. It's not like anything that is,
yeah, it's just
too far stretched.
نعم, he says Ibn Qudama, he says دون خروج عن العادة. and he doesn't go outside the norms. These people are just singing, like,
And it just uses motivation and things like that, just to
which the evidence is shown. Fine. Second one, which is al-ghina al-muharram, it's haram, which is when it becomes يعني على وجه التلحين والتطريب والتمطيط والتكسير والتهييج للنفوس مما يحرك الساكن ويبعث الكامنة. This one, the issue with it is that the person raises his voice, but now he's following a melody, he's following a rhythm, he's following, it's something outside the norms. This is something the Arabs, by the way, didn't even know that aslan. في جاهليتها, even in the جاهلية times, even لا في صدر الإسلام, even when they entered Islam, they didn't know this. It was not something they knew. This came from them by the Ajam, the foreigners and the people who are non-Muslims. وأهل التخنث من العرب, and also the تخنث of the Arabs. We said that the word people who, what was it again? The word you use?
Hermaphrodite, I think.
Hermaphrodites. And also some أهل الظاهر and تصوف مما لا اعتدوا بقول في وفاقي أو خلاف. Arabs, generally speaking, didn't know this. It was introduced by people who had tasawwuf later onwards into Islam. And of course, people had takhannuth in them. Ibn Abdul Barr, he says, وَأَمَّا الْغِنَاءُ الَّذِي كَرِهَهُ الْعُلَمَى. He said, as for the singing.
You just said kari. That means makrooh.
The word makrooh, according to the Salaf, rahimahumullah, is referred to haram. Imam Alauddin al-Mardawi, he says, يُطْلَقُ الْمَكْرُوهُ وَيُرَادُ بِهِ الْحَرَامُ وَكَثِيرٌ فِي كَلَامِ الْإِمَامِ أَحْمَدُ وَغَيْرِ مِنَ الْمُتَقَدِّمِينَ. Ibn al-Najjar also said the same. He said, al-makruh fi urf al-mutaqaddimin. The word makruh, according to the early scholars, okay, it's referring to, which is haram.
We know, obviously, it's not.
Sorry, mutaakhirin, sorry. The mutaqaddimin is haram. The mutaakhirin is lit-tanzih. Yani us, we refer to it as, yani,
something disliked. Not haram, but disliked.
Ibn al-Qayyim has a very powerful statement of his in his I'lam al-Muqa'in, where he really explains it. But he gives an example of it happening in the Qur'an. Like Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا. Allah is, and Allah destined that we do not worship anybody other than Allah. That's shirk, right? And then Allah mentions, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا. And then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala mentions, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. So we have shirk, we have zina, we have killing an innocent person. After the ending of the page, Allah says in Surah Al-Isra, he says, كُلُّ ذَلِكَ كَانَ سَيِّئُهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ مَكْرُوهًا. All of that to your Lord is makruh. Right. Makruh here doesn't mean litanzih, it means litharim. Allah mentioned shirk, Allah mentioned zina, Allah mentioned subhanahu wa ta'ala killing.
Which are all haram, obviously.
By unanimous agreement, no one's going to dispute that. So, and that's another important thing, which is we can't take a term, use urful mutaakhirin, and we force it on the urful mutaqaddimin.
So I interrupted you through that statement.
So Ibn Abdul Barr, rahimahullah, he says, وَأَمَّا الْغِنَاءُ الَّذِي كَرِهَهُ السَّلَفُ أَمَا كَرِهَهُ الْعُلَمَاءُ فَهَذَا الْغِنَاءُ بِتَقْطِيعُ حُرُوفِ الْهِجَاءُ وَإِفْسَادِ وَزْنِ الشِّعْرِ وَتَمْطِيطِ طَلَبًا لِلَّهُ وَالطَّرْبِ وَخُرُوجًا عَنْ مَذَاهِ بِالْعَرَبِ. It's very important. Abdul Barr summarizes it for me. He says, rahimahullah, as for the singing which the Salaf يعني prohibited, كَرِهَهُ الْعُلَمَى يعني حَرَّمَهُ الْعُلَمَى فَهَذَا الْغِنَى بِتَقْطِيعُ الْحُرُوفِ الْهِجَاءِ. So when the person cuts up the letters in a particular way, وَإِفْسَادِ وَزْنِ الشِّعْرِ, and destroys the form of poetry that the Arabs were aware of. By the way, these عُرُوضًا قَوَافِي that we study in poetry is something they knew. The person breaks it. And he introduces this new, يعني studied, learnt, you learn it. It's a science. Singing is a science you learn. وَالتَّمْطِيط طَلَبًا لِلَّهُ وَالطَّرَبِي وَخُرُوجًا عَنْ مَذَاهِبِ الْعَرَبِ. This is the one that the Salaf and the Ulama prohibited.
And this is just with the voice still? We're just talking
this
about the voice?
This is all by the voice.
Okay.
Keeping in mind that if the يعني عبادات which are مشروعة, the legislated acts of worship such as الأذان and قراءة القرآن, if someone does it in that way, and if someone does it in that way, it's not even allowed, let alone if you did it in normal human words.
Say that point again.
If someone was to take al-ibadat al-mashru'a, the legislated ibadat such as adhan, qira'at al-Qur'an, and the person, they came with lahan and tatrib, they read it and recited it in a musical way.
Okay.
Then this is not allowed. You're not allowed to do that to the...
Even for acts of worship, like reciting the Qur'an.
Of course. An imam... Sahib al-Mabsoot mentions it, al-Hawi al-Kabir, you can find it, al-Furu' al-Muflih, they speak about it. Yani Qur'an, you can't do that in. And scholars yani clarify that. Ibn al-Qayyim has a very powerful statement. I would encourage the people to go and read it from the third volume, page 493 in Izad al-Ma'ad. He clarifies the two types that I mentioned. He says the first one is maqtadatu al-tabi'ah. The first one is natural.
Okay.
When you hear someone saying it, it's like, Allahumma barik, Allah has given you a nice voice. That's what you would say to that person. And that's the one Abu Musa al-Ash'ari who said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet heard him recite the Qur'an, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was amazed with his voice. He said to the Prophet, لَوْ عَلِمْتُ بِمَكَانِكَ لَحَبَّرْتُهُ لَكَ تَحْبِيرًا أَمَا لَحَبِّرْتُهُ لَكَ تَحْبِيرًا. If I was to know that you were standing, that you were listening to me, the Prophet, O Prophet of Allah, I would have beautified my voice for you. The second one is, he says, مَكَانَ مِنْ دَلِكَ صِنَاعَةَ مِنَ الصَّلَاعِ. It's actually a profession from the professions out there. And it's outside الطَّبْعُ of a person. وَلَيْسَ فِي الطَّبْعِ السَّبَحَةُ. Bihi, the person is not natural. It comes from, he says, بِالتَّكَلُّفِ وَالتَّصَنُّعِ وَالتَّمَرُّنِ. You have to train. You get it wrong, you get told, go back. You say this properly. He will listen to you and he'll say, down, go up.
Right.
It comes with all of that. This type, يعني, it's the one that's not permitted and it's not allowed.
Okay. I just have a question on the second type then, because I think this is, just to bring it back to the contemporary discussion then, are we talking about just singing or are we talking about listening to this as well?
I haven't come to it yet. I'm just saying the person singing. For now, I'm just talking about for just the person to sing. Yeah, I haven't come to listening to it. I also haven't spoken about musical instruments.
I know we haven't.
I'm just talking about singing. Okay. This second type, it's mutafaqun ala tahrimi. It's unanimously agreed upon being haram. من الصحابة والتابعين والأئمة الأربعة وأصحاب المذاهب majority أكثر المحققين they stated it clearly أن أهل الحديث the people opposed is عبيد بن عبد الله بن الحسن العنبري who died in 168 he went against it and إبراهيم بن سعد القرشي who died in 183 and also ابن حزم الظاهري who died in 456 هجرية and أبو حامد الغزالي who died in 505 هجرية and محمد بن طاهر القيصراني who died in 507 They opposed it. Lakin ijma was already there before them. The unanimous agreement is already there before them. The clear-cut text from the Qur'an and the Sunnah was already there before them. وَلِذَلِكَ الْإِمَامُ الْقَاضِي الطَّبَرِي when he has a kitab called الرَّدُّ عَلَى مَنْ يُحِبُّ السَّمَعَ Refutation on the one who loves to do sama'a. I'm going to come to sama'a later, inshallah. He says, أَجْمَعَ عُلَمَاءُ الْأَمْصَارِ So the ulama are unanimously in agreement. عَلَى كَرَاهَةِ الْغِنَى كَرَاهَةُ already took it means prohibition والمنع منه it's not allowed وإنما فارق الجماعة the people went against the jama'a هذان الرجلان these two men and they are إبراهيم بن سعد and وعبيد الله and إبراهيم بن سعد القرشي and عبيد الله بن الحسن العنبري both of them he mentioned إجماع but he didn't consider the خلاف as a خلاف ابن رجب did the same thing he has a kitab called نزهة الأسماع page 20 he says رحمه الله تعالى he says أن يقع على وجه اللعب واللهو فالأكثر على تحريم ذلك أعني سماع الغناء وكل منهم محرم he says وقد حكى أبو بكر الآجري وغيره إجماع العلماء على ذلك he says that الإمام الآجري brought an إجماع in this issue so this issue is not a disputed matter to be honest if you look at the early scholars of Islam يعني early scholars and the ones who opposed it we say لا يعتد بخلافهم their خلاف is not given any consideration inshallah ta'ala as we talk more into this issue I'm gonna
yeah I have some questions about that as well
بإذن الله الكريم any person you're gonna quote today or any statement of the أئمة السلف من الصحابة والتابعين ومن تابعهم بإحسان that you say they listen to music these are the three points that your points are not going to go outside of. The whole discussion that you're going to bring is going to go back to one of these three. يعني, anyone you bring me from the scholars I admire, I look up to, you look up to, we both respect. Again, those who, يعني, Muhammad ibn Tahir al-Qaysarani, Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, Ibn Hazmin and Shawkani and others, يعني, we say they left the ijma. We're not talking about it. We're talking about the ones who were at the time of the Salaf, من الصحابة, and تابعين, ومن تابعهم بإحسان. Any one of them who you bring me, their issue doesn't go out of one of these three. So I always want us to come back to these three points.
Okay, the three points
are, number one, أنه غناء مباح. It was a غناء which is permissible. It's fine. The first type that we were talking about, which doesn't go out of حد الاعتدال والتكلف الجاري على غير سنن العرب. That's the first one. The second, so it's going to be the singing which is permissible, you and I just spoke about. The second one is أنه سمعوه, they heard it. في أوقات مخصوصة they heard it at specific times كأيام العيد like days of عيد والعرس والقدوم day of wedding a day of marriage or a day when someone was coming so someone special okay which the sunnah has permitted all of that The third one is أنهم سمعوه من خاصة النساء والجواري. This was restricted by women doing it. Mm-hmm. And the men weren't doing it. And this act, scholars unanimously agree that it's a woman's, it's permitted for women to sing. For men, singing.
Which kind of singing are you talking about?
I'm talking about the second type. Yeah, the second type.
Okay. Women can do that. Women have an exception.
Women are allowed to sing on the days of wedding, which I'm going to speak about. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah mentions in his Zad, he says, وَكُلُّ مَنْ لَهُ عِلْمٌ بِأَحْوَالِ السَّلَفِ. Anyone who knows the situation of the pious predecessors, يَعْلَمُ قَطْعًا, he will clearly come to the conclusion, أَنَّهُمْ بُرَآءُ مِنَ الْقِرَاءَةِ بِأَلْحَانِ الْمُوسِقَى, that they are far from singing with musical instrument, which is المتكلفة التي هي إيقاعات وحركات موزولة معدودة محدودة. They're singing the rhythms of the voices and all of that, and instruments, he says. وَأَنَّهُمْ أَتْقَلْ لِلَّهِ مِنْ أَنْ يَقْرَأُوا بِهَا, and they were pious people to do such a thing. وَيَسُوغُوهَا بِ وَيَعْلَمُ قَطْعًا أَنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يَقْرَؤُونَ بِالتَّحْزِينِ وَالتَّطْرِيبِ وَيُحَسِّنُونَ أَصْوَاتَهُمْ بِالْقُرْآنِ. So Ibn al-Qayyim says, anyone who knows the Salaf will realize that they were not people who sang, who read musical, يعني, used musical instruments, or forced themselves to make their words, يعني, rhyme according to the musicians and singers. Ibn Rajab said the same thing, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his kitab Nusatul Asma'. He says, سَمَاعُ الْآلَاتِ اللَّهُ لَا يُعْرَفُ عَلَى حَدٍ مِمَّنْ سَلَفَ الرُّخْصَةُ فِيهَا إِنَّمَا يُعْرَفُ ذَلِكَ عَنْ بَعْضِ الْمُتَأْخِرِينَ مِنَ الظَّاهِرِيَّةِ الصُّوفِيَّةِ مِمَّنْ لَا يُعْتَدُ بِهِ. Ibn Rajab says, listening to musical instruments, he says, that's not known from anyone of the Salaf. What is known from is the mutaakhirin, from the Zahiriyya and the Sufiyya.
Okay.
Hafiz ibn Hajar, he said the same. Ibn Hajar actually said, وَأَمَا اسْتِمَاعُ الْآلَاتِ الْمَلَاهِ الْمُطْرِبَةِ الْمُتَلَقَّاتِ مِنْ وَضْعِ الْأَعَاجِمِ فَمُحَرَّمٌ مُجْمَعٌ عَلَى تَحْرِيمِهِ وَلَا يُعْلَمُ عَنْ أَحَدٍ مِنْهُمُ الرُّخْصَةُ فِي شَيْءٍ مِنْ ذَلِكَ وَمَنْ نَقَلَ الرُّخْصَةَ فِيهِ عَنْ إِمَامٍ يُعْتَدُّ بِهِ فَقَدْ كَذَبَ وَافْتَرَى. He says, Ibn Hajar. This is something he says, subhanAllah, Ibn Hajar, his kalam is very shadeed and it's qawi. He says, you listen to musical instruments, which was taken from the يعني, Ajam, Arabs didn't know this. He says, فَمُحَرَّمٌ وَجْمَعٌ عَلَى تَحْرِيمِ. It's haram, and it's haram is unanimously agreed upon. Then look what he said. He says, وَلَا يُعْلَمُ, it's not known, عَنْ أَحْمَدَ وَلَا يُعْلَمُ عَنْ أَحْمَدَ مِنْهُ الرُّخْصَةِ. Ahmad Muhammad is not known to give permissibility فِي شَيْءٍ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. وَمَنْ نَقَلَ الرُّخْصَةَ, anyone who brings رُخْصَة, يعني permissibility, عَنْ إِمَامٍ, from an imam, يُعْتَدُّ بِهِ, which we take serious, فَقَدْ كَذَبَ وَافْتَرَى, that person has lied. Ibn al-Jawzi in his kitab Talbisu Iblis, where he speaks about the deceptions of shaitan, he explains, رحمه الله تعالى, he says, وَقَدْ كَانَ رُؤَسَاءُ الشَّافِعِي يُنْكِرُونَ السَّمَعَ وَأَمَّا قُدَمَاؤُهُمْ فَلَا يُعْرَفُ بَيْنَهُمْ خِلَافٌ وَأَمَّا أَكَابِرُ الْمُتَأَخِرِينَ فَعَلَى الْإِنْكَارِ وَمَنْ أَضَافَ إِلَى الشَّافِعِي هَذَا فَقَدْ كَذَبَ عَلَيْهِ. Ibn Salah says this, and if you say it, Abu Ahmed, he didn't allow it. Shafi'i didn't allow it. Ibn al-Jawzi mentions it.
Okay, I know. I don't want to get too deep into discussion because I've also got some points I want to contribute, but I just want to finish this foundation. So far, you've said music is of three types.
Uh-huh.
The first type, which is the permissible type,
uh-huh.
And that is basically just raising your voice, but mm-hmm. not going out of like really mm-hmm. emphasizing it mm-hmm. too much. It's just mm-hmm. something that's natural, and mm-hmm. it can be used in situations like trying to encourage yourself or for your animals and things like that. The second one is the impermissible type, which is still no instruments involved, still just your voice, but you're doing it in the kind of melody tone that is not natural, and it's like a skill and it's like a profession and things like that. And the only exception for that is women. Is that exception women at all times, or is it women in specific circumstances?
In circumstances which are specific.
Okay, so the only exception for that is women in special circumstances. What's the third type of ghina?
It's called al-ghina al-sufi.
Okay.
This ghina al-sufi, it's actually the second type that we took,
yeah.
But then the problem with this one, they made it qurbah wa ta'ah lillahi rabbil alameen. They actually get closer to Allah by doing it.
I see.
They've added something else on it, which makes it an innovation. So it's a sin, but they get closer to Allah by doing it. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah mentioned in his Fathul Bari, he says, قال القرطبي, يعني أبي عبد الله القرطبي, وَأَمَّا مَبْتَدَعَهُ الصُّوفِيَّ, that which the Sufiyya introduced, في ذلك, in this issue, فَمِنْ قَبِيلِ مَا لَا يُخْتَلَفُ فِي تَحْرِيمِ, there's no dispute in this matter. There's no khilaf in this issue. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he says, فَهَؤُلَاءِ ضُلَّالٌ بِاتِّفَاقِ عُلَمَاءِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. These are misguided people by unanimous agreement of the Muslims. وَلَا يَقُولُ أَحَدٌ مِنْ أَئِمَّةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And no one from the Muslims, scholars of Islam, would say, إِنَّ اتِّخَاذَ هَذَا دِينًا وَطَرِيقًا عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى أَمْرٌ مُبَحٌ. That doing this is يعني, a way to get closer to Allah and it's permissible. بَلْ مَنْ جَعَلَ هَذَا دِينًا وَطَرِيقًا إِلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ ضَالٌ مُضِلٌّ مُخَالِفُ الْإِجْمَاعِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. This person, he said, is misguided. He's misguiding others. And he opposes the ijma' of the Muslims.
Okay.
Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah, he transmits the kalam of al-Qadhi Abi al-Tib al-Tabari in Mas'alat al-Sama'. He says, وَاعْتِقَادُ هَذِهِ الطَّرِيقَةِ مُخَالِفُ الْإِجْمَاعِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ لِأَنَّهُمْ جَعَلُوا الْغِنَى دِينًا وَطَاعًا. So these people,
in English,
they took something which was haram, and then they made this something they get closer to Allah by doing. He said, وَاعْتِقَادُ هَذِهِ الطَّائِفَة. The belief of these people is مخالف لجماعة المسلمين. It goes against the Muslims.
Okay.
The unanimous agreement of the Muslims.
Okay, so you split up music into, or you start singing into three types.
Yes.
First one being permissible, second one being impermissible, and the third one is when people actually take the impermissible form and they use it in an attempt to get closer to Allah.
Yes.
It's like an innovation in the religion. Question at this point is, what if people use the first type which is permissible, but they use it in a method to, with the intention of getting closer to Allah? Is that allowed?
No, it's not an act of worship. It's an aadah and norms. It becomes an innovation, but it's not as worse as the second one. It's not as... ولذلك, I want to say to the people who listen to music, who are trying to justify it, who are trying to look for these qil and qal, a statement Ibn al-Jawzi says in his kitab Talbisu Iblis. He says, يَنْبَغِي لِلْعَاقِلِ أَنْ يَنْصَحَ نَفْسَهُ وَإِخْوَانَهُ. It is upon every smart person to be sincere advisor to himself and to his brothers. وَيَحْذَرَ تَلْبِيسَ Iblis. And he stays away from the deceptions of shaitan. في إجراء هذا الغناء المحرم. In this prohibited music. مجرى الأقسام المتقدمة التي يطلق عليها اسم الغناء. فلا يحمل الكل محملا واحدا. فيقول قد أباحه فلان وكرهه فلان. He says, be warned of shaitan and his deceptions. And how shaitan wants to play with you. He wants to take you to this music. And the types that we mentioned. He mentions the three types I told you. In his kitab Talbis Iblis, type which is permitted, type which is prohibited, and a third type which is innovation, and not just prohibited alone.
Okay.
Don't mix those three, he's saying to you. And take this one to use it from it, this one, stay away from it. And also he warns against يعني, the statement of saying Fulan made it permissible, so-and-so made it permissible. Remember, it's religion. Don't let shaitan deceive you.
So far we haven't talked about instruments yet. This is all just singing with a voice, right? Okay, a few questions that I have at this stage then. First of all, you just said don't make it an issue of Fulan said it's permissible, Fulan said it's haram. Yeah. That's exactly what you're doing when you quote all these scholars that ijma. You're relying on the opinions of men.
So the evidences that support me are the Qur'an, the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and the ijma. And أقوال أهل العلم من الصحابة والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. I'm going to mention some statements inshallah ta'ala if time allows it. أصحاب المذاهب الأربعة والحديث, some of their statements. I'm going to mention الإمام مالك and شافعي and أحمد and the مذاهبs and أبو حنيفة, what he said. So this, by the way, it goes in line with the مقاصد الشريعة. It goes in line with the قواعد الكلية. It goes in line with the كتاب and the سنة and the إجماع and the أقوال أهل العلم. There are five verses in the Qur'an, five ayat in the Qur'an that prohibits music.
And we're going to get to them. And I do want to discuss them in more detail. But before we do, again, this issue of ijma' that you're mentioning. Imam Ahmed said, rahimahullah, anybody who claims ijma' fahuwa kathib. Anybody who claims ijma' then he's a liar. And yet you're using this ijma' as a proof for yourself. How do you reconcile between that?
Okay, let me go to Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah, statement which... You're not the only person who uses it. A lot of people use the statement of Imam Ahmad, مَنِ دَعَ الْإِجْمَعَ فَهُوَ كَاذِبٌ. They say, Ahmed said this. I'm going to respond to this from two perspectives. The first one is, Imam Ahmad himself has used ijma as a proof.
But was that before he made the statement, this nasikh and mansukh, or what?
No, Ahmad, over the board, he used ijma. His a'immat of his madhabs have also said ijma as a proof for Ahmad in many issues. The second point, inshallah ta'ala, in response to your question, I want to say is, what did Ahmed actually mean by when he said, Man idda'a al-ijma', Anyone who claims ijma' fawa kadhib is a liar. What did he mean by that? So first of all, let me prove to you, Ahmed, many issues here, many issues. I'm only going to mention some that he, rahimahullah ta'ala, used ijma'. His son, Abdullah, Ibn al-Imam Ahmed, in his Masail, he narrated from his father, he said, قلت لي أبي, I said to my father, إذا لم يكن, if there isn't, عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, if it's not from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, في ذلك شيء, if there's nothing from the Prophet in this issue, مشروع that legislates it, يخبر فيه عن خصوم, عن خصوص أو عموم, general or specific. What do we do in a situation like that? He said, if the, we haven't got something from the Prophet in this issue, whether it be general or specific, that permits this issue, what do we do? Al-Imam Ahmed said to his son, he said, يُنظَرُ, it's looked at ما عَمِلَ بِهِ الصَّحَابَ, that which the companions did. فَيَكُونُ ذَلِكَ مَعْنَى الْآيَةِ, that becomes the meaning of the verse. He then says, فَإِنْ اخْتَلَفُوا, if they differ. Ponder on this. If the Sahabas have acted upon this ayah in this way, then that's it. But if they differ, يعني the ijma' al-Sahaba is using here.
Right.
رحمه ta'ala. He said, but if they differ, يُنظَرُ, it's looked at أَيُّ الْقَوْلَيْنِ, which of the two قَوْلَ, about whatever views out there from the Sahabas, أَشْبَهُ بِقَوْلِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَكُونُ الْعَمَلُ عَلَيْهِ. We look at which of the Sahabas is in line with the evidence.
So if they don't differ, then you don't even need to look at, no. You just accept it.
Exactly. The second one is Al-Imam Abu Dawood in his Masail also, he asked Al-Imam Ahmed. He said, I heard Ahmed, سَمِعْتُ أَحْمَدُ قِيلَ لَهُ, I heard Ahmed, it was said to him, إِنَّ فُلَانًا قَالَ, so-and-so said, قِرَاءَةُ فَاتِحَةِ الْكِتَابِ, reciting Suratul Fatiha behind the Imam is specific with the verse, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَبِعُوا لَهُ, فَقَالَ عَمَّنْ يَقُولُ هَذَا, he said, who's saying this? أَجْمَعَ النَّاسِ أَنَّ هَذِي الْآيَةُ فِي الصَّلَاةِ, he says, this is the part I want. Ahmed said, أَجْمَعَ النَّاسِ, the scholars have unanimously agreed upon, أَنَّ هَذِي الْآيَةِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ, that this ayah is referring to the salah. Abu Ya'la, if you go to, which is he, Abu Ya'la al-Farra, he's Imam al-Hanabilah fi asrihi. وَكَانَ عَالِمُ عَصْرِ فِي الْأُصُولِ وَالْفُرُوعِ رَحِمَهُ ta'ala, was born the year 380 Hijriya. He has a kitab called Al-Udda fi Usul al-Fiqh. He mentions the ijma' for Ahmed is a nas, and it's an evidence. So that's the first point.
But are you sure that all of these ijma' that you narrated from Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah, they didn't come first and then later
these books were documented after.
After his statement for Huwa Kadhibun.
I mean, Abu Ya'la came after Imam Ahmed. I said he was born 380 Hijriya.
Yeah, but that's not Imam Ahmed himself. That's just a narration from Imam Ahmed.
So these a'imma have understood from Imam Ahmed that ijma' is a proof.
And their understanding might be wrong, right?
They are a'imma
to sarih statement of Imam Ahmed for Huwa Kadhibun.
We're going to come to what he meant by that. But I'm just first point I wanted to speak about is Ahmed used ijma' as evidence. Also, these are a'immatul madhab, the a'imma of the madhab. As I mentioned to Abu Ya'la al-Farra, is Imam al-Hanabilah fi asrihi. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, in his kitab al-Muswadda fi usul al-fiqh, if you go to page 282, you find it there. Clearly, rahimahullah mentioned Ahmed's view in the issue of ijma'. Now let's go to the meaning of what Ahmed meant by rahimahullah, man idda'a al-ijma'a fahuwa kadhib. What did he mean by it? If you actually go to the statement in its full version, and if you've got it there, you find Ahmed rahimahullah says, man idda'a al-ijma'a fahuwa kadhib, la'alla an-nasa qad ikhtalafu, hadhihi da'awa bishr al-marisi wal-asam.
What does that mean?
Ahmed says, anyone who claims ijma' is a liar.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe the people have differed. These are the claims of bishr al-marisi and al-asam. Now, who's bishr al-marisi? Bishr ibn al-Marisi is Bishr ibn Ghiyath al-Marisi. He's a Ibn Hajar, he says in Lisan al-Mizan, he says, مُبْتَدِعٌ ضَالٌ لَا يَنْبَغِي أَنْ يُرْوَى عَنْهُ وَلَا كَرَامَةٌ. No one should narrate anything from Bishr al-Marisi. He's an innovator, Ibn Hajar is saying this, and he's misguided. No one should ever narrate from him. وَلَا كَرَامَةٌ has no honor whatsoever. Khatib al-Baghdadi mentions in his tariq, he says, زِنْدِيق. And he brings that statement from who? Abu Zur'at al-Razi. Abu Zur'at says, Bishr al-Marisi is zindiq, a heretic. Also, Yazid ibn Harun, he said about him, Bishr al-Marisi kafirun halalud dam.
Wow.
He said he's a kafir and his blood is permissible. That's first of all, Bishr al-Marisi. The second person is Al-Asam that Ahmed mentioned here in the statement. Al-Asam is Abu Bakr al-Asam, he's Shaykh al-Mu'tazila, Shaykh of the Mu'tazila. Hafidh ibn Hajar, Hafidh ibn Rajab, sorry, in Sharh Ula li-Tirmidhi, he mentions, وَأَمَّا مَا رُوِيَ مِنْ قَوْلِ لِإِمَامِ أَحْمَدِ مَنِ ادَّعَ الْإِجْمَعَ فَقَدْ كَذَبْ. Ibn Rajab is the Imam of the Madhab. He knows his Imam Ahmed. He says, فَهُوَ إِنَّمَا قَالَهُ إِنْكَارٌ عَلَى فُقَهَاءِ الْمُعْتَزِلَةِ الَّذِينَ يَدَّعُونَ الْإِجْمَاعَ النَّاسِ عَلَى مَا يَقُولُونَهُ وَكَانُوا أَقَلَّ النَّاسِ مَعْرِفَةً بِأَقْوَالِ الصَّحَابَةِ وَتَابِعِينَ. And he's saying, Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, He said Ahmed's statement here was referring to Bishr al-Marisi and what's called Abu Bakr al-Asam, Shaykh al-Mu'tazila, who used to just make merely claim ijma' in everything.
Mm.
When they were the most ignorant people when it came to knowing the aqwal of the sahabas and the tabi'in, they didn't know anything about chains. And then they would just claim ijma', 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 okay. And everything.
Okay.
Ibn Taymiyyah also mentions it. He said, إِنَّمَا فُقَهَاءُ الْمُتَكَلِّمِينَ كَالْمَرِيسِ وَالْأَصَمِ يَدَّعُونَ الْإِجْمَاعَ وَلَا يَعْرِفُونَ إِلَّا قَوْلَ أَبِي حَنِيفَةَ وَمَالِكَ وَنَحْوِهِمَا. They only knew the statement of Abi Hanifa and Malik and other than them. وَلَا يَعْلَمُونَ أَقْوَالَ صَحَابَةِ وَالتَّابِعِينَ. So this statement of Ahmed rahimahullahu ta'ala, which he brought, Mani da'al ijma', and it needs to be put in its right place.
So in the context, obviously, that he was referring to a specific group of people, uh-huh. And he's not talking mutlaqan, like
mutlaqan, unrestrictedly. Unrestrictedly.
Okay. Unrestrictedly, okay. The asl for acts of worship is that they're haram, unless you have an evidence to make it halal. And
the adat are?
The opposite way around, right? For the adat, for the things in the dunya, the normal things, the customary things, the asl is that they're permissible and you need to bring in evidence to show the haram. So the fact that you've mentioned a few hadith in your introduction where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it happened at the time of Eid and at the time of a wedding and this happened and therefore it's permissible in this situation, this, I say no. The asl is that singing, which is something in the dunya, it's not an act of worship. Obviously singing without the intention of getting close to Allah is what I'm talking about. Singing aslan is permissible until you bring in evidence to say it's haram. What's your evidence?
I mentioned that my evidence is from the Qur'an and the sunnah and the ijma' of the ummah. Yani I'm not saying this issue is disputed. I'm saying this issue is unanimously agreed upon that it's not permissible. And of course, when I now talk, I hope the listeners who are watching me are understanding when I say al-ghina, I'm referring to the second type that we took in the introduction. The kitab doesn't, Quran doesn't allow it. The sunnah doesn't allow it. The ijma' doesn't allow
it. Are we going to talk about musical instruments at any point, by the way?
We can bring it, inshallah ta'ala, of course.
Is that included in these?
Yes, by unanimous, it's ijma'. There's no difference of opinion on that.
Okay, let's go into the evidences then, that you have to say that this second type, obviously we're excluding the first type, which we already said is permissible. The second type is haram.
Inshallah ta'ala. Let me bring you, there's five ayat in the Quran that I can bring, inshallah ta'ala. The first one is, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهُ الْحَدِيثِ لِيُضِلَّ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ وَيَتَّخِذَهَا هُزْوًا أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُهِينٌ. In Surah Al-Luqman, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ, from amongst the people, are those مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهُ الْحَدِيثِ لِيُضِلَّ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ وَيَتَّخِذَهَا هُزْوًا أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُهِينٌ. There are from amongst the people those who buy lahu al-hadith.
Okay.
Now we have to, now we've got an ayah.
Yeah.
When an ayah comes up like that, what we have to do is we have to say, okay, what did the early imams of Islam say about this?
Fine, okay.
The people, we take it back to other companions, number one.
Okay.
Did the Sahabas comment on this verse? Did they have an understanding on this verse? Of
ideally,
course.
I like to take it to the Prophet ﷺ, ideally.
If the Prophet ﷺ didn't say anything about it, or another verse from the Quran did not point this particular verse out, then what we are now going to move on to is the companions. You're right, we do the Quran with the Quran,
correct.
And then the Quran with the Sunnah, and then we do the Quran with the
And those Sahabas. First two things, Tafsir al-Quran bil-Quran, did it come to explain this particular lahu al-hadith? Okay, and then the Sunnah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi
wa sallam. We don't have the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam
saying. So again, we have to go to fallible men.
But we were commanded to go back to the companions. As Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said in the Quran, Allah says, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And they follow a path other than the path of the believers. Also the Prophet said in the hadith, عِرْبَاضُ بْنُ سَارِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين عضوا عليها بالنواجد.
A path other than the believers. Where did you get companions in that?
That ayah, when it came down, who were the believers at that time?
Companions.
You and I were not there at that time.
Hmm.
Also, Allah تبارك وتعالى said, والسابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين اتبعوهم. Allah mentioned the مهاجرين and the أنصار and those who follow them, hoping inshallah تعالى, may Allah make us from those people.
Mm-hmm.
So now we have to take this verse to the Sahabas.
Okay, agreed.
So the Sahabas, رضوانullah عليهم أجمعين, we have three noble companions, three, يعني not just companions, but real knowledgeable imams and ulama of the Sahabas commenting on this verse. We have Ibn Mas'ud, who didn't just say lahu al-hadith means ghina, he actually swore by Allah. This is not just a mere statement, it's just ghina like that. Two riwayat mentioned. He says, Wallahi, in one version, he swore by Allah, that this is music. And in another wording, he said, La walladhi la ilaha ghayruh. Walladhi la ilaha ghayruh. I swear by the Lord, there is none worthy of worship, that this is music. That's Ibn Mas'ud. Imagine a Sahabi had to swear that shows you the seriousness of it.
So that's his opinion?
Wallahi, we're going to come to that issue. Is it just his opinion? We're going to come to it. Ibn Abbas, the man who the Prophet made du'a for, salawatullahi wa salamun alayhi, turjuman al-Qur'an, the most knowledgeable man in the Qur'an, Ibn Abbas, the Prophet made du'a for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Allahumma faqihu fi deen wa alimhu ta'wil. Ibn Abbas said, lahu al-hadith is music. Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. When he came to the ayah, he says, lahu al-hadith. And then from the other scholars, the imams of Islam, we have Sa'id ibn Jubayr, we have Mujahid ibn Jabri. Sufyan al-Thawri said, إِذَا جَاءَكَ تَفْسِيرُ مُجَاهِدٍ فَحَسْبُكَ بِهِ. If the tafsir of Mujahid comes to you, that's enough. Mujahid. Ikrima. We have Ibrahim al-Nakha'i. We have Hassan al-Basri. We have Maymun. We have Makhul. And other than them, all of whom said, لَهُ الْحَدِيثِ means music here. The ayah, look what it says. It says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ, from the people are those who buy لَهُ الْحَدِيثِ. Why? لِيُضِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, to misguide from the path, the straight path of Allah. بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, they misguide from the straight path of Allah. بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, with no knowledge. وَيَتَّخِذَهَا هُزُوًا, أُولَٰئِكَ, tell those people, inform those people, let them know that for these people is عَذَابٌ مُهِيمٌ, a severe punishment. Now I want to say something very powerful here. When Abdullah ibn Abbas said this, Ibn Mas'ud said this, Ibn Umar said this, this is a statement that became famous amongst the Sahabas.
How do you know it spread amongst the Sahabas?
The fact that we have no one from the three noble generations commenting on this issue.
Shows that it hasn't become famous.
It did. We have to, this is very important that we understand. This is a mas'ala, important, very important. A issue, a statement of Ibn Mas'ud and Ibn Abbas and Ibn Umar is quoted on, it's not one companion that said it, and then the others, as we're talking about three big companions, and we know our Prophet alayhi salatu was, Allah azza wa jalla promised us, Allah made an oath, inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun, we have sent down the revelation and we're going to protect it. For us to think that this is what the Sahabas believed, because we don't have anyone who said Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Abbas, Ibn Umar, this is wrong. This is wrong.
Not what if even they never one. Heard it? What if it never, they've never
reached
it?
No, even
them?
One other companion.
Yeah, what if it never reached them? And they were just so, they, the asl is permissible, so they're all upon the asl.
So Sa'id ibn Jubayr, Mujahid, Ikrima, Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, Hassan al-Basri, Maymun, Makhul, Wetu Tabi'in, Wetu Ru'us al-Tabi'in, the Imams of Tabi'in.
Okay, now you're going into an issue of ijma' al-sukooti.
Yeah.
You're saying that there's an ijma' upon the companions because this statement was made and nobody opposed it.
We have no one opposing it.
We have no one opposing it. Okay, I have an issue with that. Because ijma' sukuti is not really considered as a dalil according to the majhur of the ulama.
Okay.
It's just like, for example, the Shafi'i and the Malikiyah, the majority of them don't consider it to be a dalil. It's just a fraction from the Hanabila and the Hanafiyah that would consider it to be a dalil. So what do you know that they don't?
You're right in the sense, ijma' al-sukuti, we have to divide it into two. Mujarrad ijma' al-sukuti, mere ijma' al-sukuti is not a proof. I'm with you on that. I agree with you on that.
Okay,
but
good.
إِذَا تَكَرَّرَتِ الْوَاقِعَ, if this situation reoccurs, keeps reoccurring by multiple people after that, and it happens مع تطاول الزمان, and it happens for a long period of time, the usuliyin are by unanimous agreement that this ijma al-sukut is a proof. So unanimously.
You're saying if a statement is made by multiple people across multiple generations and nobody opposes them, then by unanimous agreement, this is a proof.
And it's not just a proof. It's a proof that this is ijma al-sukut, which is a proof. And al-imam Tajuddin al-Subki mentions it in his Raf'ul Hajib, which is sharah on al-Mukhtasar ibn Hajib. If you go to the great Imam Tilmisani, he mentions it. Subki brings his statement in his works. Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni says it in his Kitab al-Burhan. Zarkashi rahimahullah. Zarkashi says it. If I even mention Zarkashi's statement, he says, Ash-shartu al-ashir. He mentions the 10th condition. And he says, Annahu wa in kana dhalika mimma yadumu wa yatakarraru wuku'uhu wal-khawdu fi fa'innahu yakunu al-sukutu ijma'an. وهذا ما اختاره الإمام الحرمين في آخر المسألة وأن محل الخلاف إذا فرض السكوت في زمن يسير. The Usuliyin only differ upon, he says, ومحل الخلاف, the place of difference is إذا فرض السكوت. Silence happens, no one objects, but it happened for a short time.
Okay, that's the one that's questionable.
Questionable amongst the ulama. I'm saying to you, this mas'ala has happened for a time. Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Abbas said it, and we have these great tabi'een all saying it after. Sa'id ibn Jubayr saying it here, Mujahid saying it here, Ikrimah saying it here, Ibrahim al-Nakha'i saying it, Hassan al-Basri saying it, Maymun, Makhul, and other than them.
And
over 23 imams have said it.
So you're standing upon this principle, but your own imam, Imam al-Shafi'i, disagrees with you.
I told you.
Shafi'i said, لا ينصبو إلى ساكت قول. He said, it can't be attributed to a silent person. Speech can't be attributed to a silent person. And of course, that makes logical sense as well. Just because the others were silent about it, you can't come along and say, I'm now going to say they also affirm and they believe in the same ruling.
This ihtijaj of qawl of Imam al-Shafi'i, لا ينصبو إلى ساكت قول, that a silent person, we cannot attribute a statement to him. We have to first of all understand what Shafi'i meant by it. Rahimahullah.
Everything goes back to what did they mean? Why can't you take the Zahir? Why do you have to make it majazi?
By the way, he said this in his kitab, Al-Umm. We go back to, we have to look at the context in which he said it, Rahimahullah ta'ala. He said it, Rahimahullah, fi halatin wahida, in one situation only, which is if a hakim is judging between Muslims in a particular issue, there is no sunnah known for it from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those who are around this hakim, they don't know a sunnah from the Prophet in this issue. This hakim is now going to judge it based on his ijtihad. Those who are around him, they are not allowed to dispute with him because they have no evidence. And he is obliged, this hakim is forced to do what? To base things on his ijtihad. He's not allowed to blind follow, he's a mujtahid. These people, even though they may oppose his opinion, it's their ijtihad. They keep silent from him because based on me doing ijtihad and you doing ijtihad and you doing ijtihad.
And you're the person authority there.
Yeah. And they all know here that it's all based on ijtihad. And no one's allowed to blind follow as they are all mujtahideen. Shafi'i is saying the ones who've chosen to be silent here and not speak to the hakim and say, look, you're wrong. They only went silent because they know their ijtihad is not stronger than an ijtihad cannot nullify another ijtihad. He said, their silence here, لا ينصب إلى ساكت قول. He mentions it clearly, rahimahullah, in his kitab al-Umm. You can go back to it in Mutawwal and he mentions it in great details. But that's a red herring, to be honest. Shafi'i, rahimahullah, himself believes in ijma' al-sukooti. Himself, when it is what? As I said to you before. He believes in it, rahimahullah, if the issue kept going. يعني, there's dawam and the wuqu'. Yeah, and something keeps going on for a very long period of time. Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala's kalam is sarih. And we've studied the madhab, so we have an understanding.
Okay, I have another issue with this lahul hadith, meaning music. Because the reason for this is clearly given, liyudilla an sabilillahi. I agree with you, if singing or music or this kind of impermissible action is used to misguide people from like, for example, some of the mufassirun, they say that when the ayat of the Qur'an were being revealed, people would try and talk over it or sing over it or try and misguide the people so they couldn't hear the verse of the Qur'an. No Muslim in his right mind is going to say this is okay. Of course it's not. But then to take that and to apply it unrestrictedly and say every single type of music, even the person at home, he's just listening to it on his own. The Quran is not recited. It's not being played. He's not trying to misguide people. He's just listening to it out of enjoyment. To say that is now not allowed because of this ayah, that's a stretch.
It's not. As we said before, the ahadiths and the Quran and the sunan, the nusus al-wahiyya, they explain one another. The ayah is saying that these music that the people listen to, it's a means of misguidance.
No, it's saying, let's get the ayah out. First of all, lahul hadith, hadith obviously being speech. You've said that some companions have interpreted that as being music. The other companions have remained silent. Therefore, we believe all companions have interpreted it as being music. That's your claim, right?
No, my claim is that these sahabas, no one said what your view. That statement is wrong. يعني كانوا يصححون بعضهم بعضا. Like, if there's اختلاف التنوع, يعني for example, someone says, يعني اختلاف التنوع, I have to explain it first. There's اختلاف sometimes amongst the sahabas in the wording of something.
Okay.
Someone might, for example, say the cup is half full and someone might say it's half empty. So they haven't differed here, but they have differed again. They've differed in their wordings, but what they're talking about is the same.
It's not a contradiction. It's just not a contradiction. From two different perspectives.
Different, yeah. So some scholars might mention different meanings for a verse all of that can fall under it.
Which is what I've got. Like some of the Sahaba said it's shirk, misleading stories.
So all of that, we don't deny it could mean it.
It doesn't contradict the fact that it can also
if we're saying it's ikhtilafu tanawwu. But we want to prove our point, which is that this meaning, there isn't ikhtilafu tadad. The Sahabas are not differing that one is saying, you're right, you're wrong, I'm right. It's not the case here.
So one is saying this is music, and another one saying this is not music.
It no, cannot it's not happening.
Okay. The second part of the ayah, لِيُدِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, this actually gives the reason why لَهُ الْحَدِيثِ is not allowed.
Okay.
It's because the people are using it to misguide people from the path of Allah. That's the only circumstance it's not allowed in.
Do you think now music today, let's be fair, because we're talking to people who live in our time, who are watching, who listen to music. Do you not believe that today, that music is a means to misguide others?
I don't think that aql should be used to rule something.
No, it's not aql, it's just...
Even this conversation, it's a logical argument that just because it's... Okay, so if in our time I say yes, but in 100 years time the music scene changes, then it's...
No,
okay,
it's getting
then.
Worse though. We can see the way it's heading right now. We can see where it's heading. And let's take this verse. Many people, and who are watching, who are munsif, who are sincere and honest to themselves, would say to you, na'am, wallahi, I agree. Music has been my downfall. My demise has come from music. It's misguiding me from many things. I don't pray anymore because I started listening to music. I now speak in a certain way, and it is a despicable way because of music. I act in a certain way because of music. And I've started to fornicate and adultery and all because of music. By the way, I want brothers and sisters who are watching to really understand this point. The music here that the Sahabas and the Tabi'in are talking about is not as bad as the ones today. The ones today, I don't think any person who's... I even think if the non-Muslims were asked, let alone the Muslims, they would say, this is not right.
I think a lot of Muslims who have contention with this, they will probably agree with you that 95% of the music out there now in existence today is terrible, it's bad, it's wrong, we should stay away from it as Muslims, we shouldn't. But to say all kinds of music, just to say someone's just listening to Beethoven's symphony, for example, just in the comfort of his own home and there's not even words, it's just noise, and he's just... To say that is based on this, it's not...
But
not convinced.
This is the point. I feel like it's very important that we all come to understanding it. And that is the... Sharia doesn't always base things on a few things. That's something minute, something very small. To make that the general rule and you forget the... You just mentioned it's 90... How many did you say?
I'm just making up numbers.
Let's say 95%. 95% of it, you said, is dangerous. Okay. You know 95% of the people are watching this. And then you come, for example, I'm just trying to... Just give a, you know, keep my top point. So even to the ones who say it's impermissible, I want to speak to them as well.
Okay.
95% of the people you know are listening to rap, and they're listening to very despicable lyrics, and they're listening to music that's very, vulgar words. And it comes with videos that have bad things in there. 95% of the people are watching that, and it talks about murdering and killing and spread blood. 95%. And then you come with the fatwa of Ibn Hazmin or Shawkani or others, and you meant in your head Beethoven's symphony. Well, it makes no sense.
Yeah, it's
like that.
Okay.
I'm just coming from that perspective, that without us going into nusus and evidences.
Mm-hmm.
But let's explain this ayah with a hadith of the Prophet. The Prophet ﷺ, there has come from him 14 evidences, 14 hadiths that say it's haram.
Music, clearly mentioned music.
Music. 14 hadiths.
Go ahead.
First one is the most famous hadith of Imam al-Bukhari, that Imam al-Bukhari narrated, وَغَيْرُهُ and other than him, in Ahli Sunan, he narrated from the Masanid, وَغَيْرِهِمْ, they narrated from Abi Malikin or Abi Amirin al-Ash'ari.
You're not even sure of the companion that was narrating this hadith, and you're trying to use it as an evidence.
The companion being unknown, La yadurru, it doesn't harm the hadith.
Why?
Because whichever of the companions it is, for example, a hadith, if there's dispute, did Abu Huraira narrate this or did Ibn Umar, for example, narrate this, it doesn't harm the hadith, because whichever direction you go or to whoever it goes back to, it's accepted. Whether Abu Huraira narrates it or Ibn Umar or Ibn Abbas or Aisha, it doesn't matter.
But if we're not sure which one of these two, how do we know it might not be a third or a fourth? We can't have certainty.
But we have many ahadiths. Ja'a rajulun ila rasulillah. A man came to the Prophet and he said, O Messenger of Allah. And ibhamu sahabi la yadur. Yani the ambiguity of a companion doesn't really harm a hadith. And anyone who studied the science of hadith knows that. So also the dispute of a name of a companion, what's his real name? Like again, Abu Huraira, there are 30 or 40 views regarding his name, Abu Huraira. What's his actual real name? Is it Abdulrahman ibn Sakhrin? Is it something else? Ali, the fact that we don't know the name of a Sahabi or doesn't matter, or details related to that. All we know is that the Sahabas are udul, reliable.
Okay.
So Imam al-Bukhari narrated it that Abi Amirin or Abi Malikin al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, I heard from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, La yakunanna, there will be in min ummati, from my ummah, qawmun, a people yastahilluna, they will permit for themselves, al-hira, which is zina, hira means al-farj, and al-harir means silk, wal-khamra and alcohol, wal-ma'azif and music. So the hadith mentions there are going to be a people who are going to make it halal for themselves. Now what I want from us to take from this hadith, a few things. First one is that the Prophet mentioned, la yakunanna, there will be. Yani the noon he used was noon al-tawqid. It's emphasis. Min ummati, from my ummah. Qawmun, a people, yastahilluna, they will make it halal for themselves. In other words, it's haram. They will make it halal for themselves. And he mentioned some things that we won't dispute that is haram. Like al-hira, zina. Wal-harira, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited what? Silk for men. Salawatullahi wa salamun alayhi. Wal-khamra, I hope no one's going to dispute the impermissibility of alcohol for now, inshallah ta'ala. And last but not least, wal-ma'azifa.
Okay.
All of these points, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned them together.
Fine. I've got questions on this hadith because I knew this would come up in our conversation. I have criticisms of this hadith from two perspectives, and of course I shouldn't say me, I'm saying those who preceded me. But the first perspective is the chain and whether this is authentic. It's very nice and very easy to just say to the people and pull the wool over their eyes and say this hadith is in Sahih Bukhari without mentioning that it's mu'allaq. It's not fully connected. It's not a fully connected chain all the way back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's important because the proper name of Sahih al-Bukhari as we know it is al-jami' al-musnad al-sahih. It is a jami', it's musnad, i.e. it's got connected chains. If Bukhari had a connected chain between himself and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I'm trying not to get too technical for the people at home. If he had a connected chain, he would have bought it in this book because that's the title of this book. The fact that he bought this hadith, this narration, without a connected chain, shows that even he doesn't believe it's sahih.
Al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, you're right, his kitab is called Al-Jami' al-Sahih al-Musnad. And it's true, his kitab, he conditioned for it to be yani, authentic, whatever he brings in it, which is connected. First of all, the narrator that you're referring to, that he didn't mention, is Hisham ibn Ammar.
So there is a narrator that you didn't mention. We agree on that.
No.
Isn't that problematic even before we get onto who the narrator is?
No, he did mention Hisham ibn Ammar, but he didn't use what scholars of hadith refer to as the siyagh al-tahammul. The way he took that narration from Hisham ibn Ammar was not sarih. They say it's not direct. He said, qala Hisham ibn Ammar. Hisham ibn Ammar said.
So he could have said it someone else and then Bukhari heard it later.
They say there's possibilities, the ones who weaken it, which I'm going to come to, they say, their argument is that they say Bukhari said, Hisham ibn Ammar said. Now, he didn't say, I heard from Hisham ibn Ammar.
Which is very important in the science of hadith, right? These kind of terminology is very important.
You're right, it's very important. Now, what we have to understand is if we're going to speak about the science of hadith, we first have to understand a few things. Number one. Hisham ibn Ammar is min shuyukh al-Bukhari. He is from the shuyukhs of Bukhari. He is Bukhari's teacher, number one. Very important that we understand that. Yani Bukhari took from Hisham ibn Ammar. That's number one. Number two, the scholars of hadith, ulama al-hadith, scholars who've grounded themselves, studied hadith, they mention an anatul Bukhari, because qala is similar to an.
Meaning for the people
the word qala and an don't show that this person heard from this person
directly.
It doesn't show it. It's not clear in showing that. So they say the qala and an is the same. An, which is also still the same. It's not, because it's not clear in that the person heard from this person. So they say an anatul Bukhari, and an here means of course the qala as well. An anatul Bukhari mahmulatun ala tisala.
In English means
Bukhari, when he uses the word an, or he uses the word qala or the likes of these words, it's connected for Bukhari. There is a reason. It's because Bukhari is not a mudallis. A mudallis means a person who wouldn't say Hisham said and he dropped out people. Bukhari is not a person who do that. He doesn't do that. So he's not a mudallis. And Ibn Hajar explained that and spoke about that in the Muqaddimah.
Why do you say qala here then?
We're going to come to it. Ibn Hajar mentions it in his Hadith Sari, if you want to call it, or his Huda Sari. He mentions it there. That Bukhari is not a mudallis, and that if he uses an or qala, it's like haddathana.
It's like he heard it from other scholars when they say haddathana.
Yes. There are some scholars when they say an, we say he's a mudallis. Where is it sarih? Let me give you a few examples. Ishaq al-Sabi'i. Ishaq al-Sabi'i. He's a mudallis. Humayd al-Tawil, for example, is a mudallis. And there are Qatad ibn Da'amat al-Sadus is a mudallis. I mean, there are people who are mudallis. If they have not narrated with haddathana or akhbarana or anba'ana, and it's not taken.
Okay, because they're known for when they say, and they're actually dropping people out the chain.
That's one. Second thing is that when Bukhari narrated, he said qala.
Yeah.
And he didn't say qila.
Okay. Yeah.
So even if we take your argument that this is just mu'allaq, but he did it with sigat al-jazm. Sigat al-jazm means he did it in an affirmed form. Bukhari, when he brings something which is mu'allaq means disconnected, he doesn't mention his shaykh. He brings it when he believes it's weak, he brings it with ruwiyah.
He's done this in other places.
Qila, of course. Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala points out in Fathul Bari, and he's also written a book called Taghliq wa Ta'liq, where he brings all of the mu'allaqat in Bukhari.
So he said Hisham ibn Ammar said, and yeah, he didn't say it was said.
So this shows us, this is called Sighatul Jazmi. That's another point that we all have to take into consideration.
Okay.
Another point that we have to really take into consideration is that the hadith itself, with the word hadathana, was narrated.
Where it's
sarih. يعني it's clearly متصل from Hisham ibn Ammar, other than Bukhari, of course. Ibn Hibban brought it in his Sahih. Al-Imam al-Tabarani brought it in his Mu'jam al-Kabir. Bayhaqi brought it in his Sunan al-Kubra. Barqani brings it in Nasb al-Raya, Lizayla'i. Hassan ibn Sufyan brings it in his Taghliq al-Ta'liq. Sunan al-Kubra, Bayhaqi also mentions the Hassan ibn Sufyan. Abu Nu'aym mentions it as well, as Ibn Hajar brings in his Taghliq al-Ta'liq. Abu Bakr al-Ismailiy, as Bayhaqi brings in his Sunan al-Kubra. Abu Dhar al-Harawi in Fathul Bari, Ibn Hajar brings it. Rahimahul. Ibn Asakir in Tariq al-Dimashq. Abu Ahmad al-Hakim, as Imam Ibn Hajar brings in his Taghliq al-Ta'liq. Tammam al-Dimashqi, as is found in the Musnad al-Mulaqin by al-Dhahabi. Also, al-Imam al-Mizzi brings in his Tahdhib al-Kamal. الذهبي بن سير على من بلا ابن حجر ان تغريق التعليق رحم الله الجميع.
So this hadith is actually present, same wording.
With, yeah, that same hadith where you said there was just qala, all of those people narrated, all of them with the wording قالوا حدثنا هشام بن عمار بإسناده بإسناده بالحديث.
Okay.
With that chain to the hadith.
Connected.
Connected. So the word حدثنا is, if that's your concern, الحمد لله, has been.
Okay.
Another point I want to mention is that this hadith has been authenticated by a'immatul kibar, a'imma kabir in ilm. The first one is Bukhari himself. When he said qala, and if we accept that it was mu'allaq, that Bukhari brought it by sighatul jazm. And if he brings it sighatul jazm, it's sahih according to him. So the hadith to Bukhari is authentic. Ibn Hibban authenticated it. Ismaili authenticated it. Abu Dhar al-Harawi authenticated it. Al-Hakim al-Naysaburi authenticated it. Ibn Salah authenticated it. Al-Barqani authenticated it. Nawawi authenticated it. Ibn Taymiyyah authenticated it. Ibn al-Qayyim authenticated it. Ibn Kathir, Ibn Rajab, Ibn Mulaqin al-Iraqi, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, al-San'ani, Ibn al-Wazir al-Yamani, al-Sakhawi, al-Shawkani, al-Dihlawi, and al-Sheikh Nasir al-Din al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala authenticated it.
And I can do the same thing. Ibn Khazmin, we can do it. Abu Hamid al-Ghazali weakened it. Imam al-Shawkani weakened it. I mean, we're just playing with names.
No, and Imam al-Shawkani authenticated his hadith. He, even though he's of the opinion that music is permissible, but he authenticated his hadith.
Okay.
To him, this hadith is sahih.
What about Abu Hamid al-Ghazali and Ibn Khazmin?
Abu Hamid al-Ghazali and Ibn Khazmin are not a'immatul hadith. We have to understand that. يعني, especially Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, bida'atu muzja. When it comes to ilmul hadith, he's hatibu layl. It's very weak in hadith. He's not seen. We're going to mention him in the context of Ibn Hajar and Nawawi and Iraqi Ibn Hajar. Abu Nawawi, sorry, Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, In hadith, he is حاطب ليل. حاطب ليل means a person at night time, he picks everything. This is not his field. Ibn Hazmina, again, he has غرائب when it comes to hadith. And he has statements which are very strange. For example, his statement like Imam al-Tirmidhi is majhool. There's many hadiths he weakens. This is not his field. This is not something we will go back to Ibn Hazm, especially when Iraqi says in his Alfiyah, he says, "An anatun kakhabari al-ma'azifi la tasqi ibn Hazm lil-mukhalifi." Iraqi, the Shaykh of Ibn Hajar, he says the hadith, "An anatul Bukhari," this hadith. And he authenticates it and he says, don't give any attention to what Ibn Hazm said. And he's an Imam al-Hadith, Ibn
Zainuddin al-Iraqi. So the well-known scholars for the science of hadith have
strengthened this hadith. And I would encourage anyone, inshallah ta'ala, who's munsif, who's sincere, to go to the kitab Ighathatul Lahfan fi Masaid al-Shaytan by al-Imam Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. That kitab is muhim jiddan for a student of knowledge to read. He responds to all of their doubts that they might bring regarding the hadith and issues related to it. So it's a very... Kalam, mashallah, first volume, page 391, you'll find the response to a lot of the points. Sheikh Albani has Tahrim alat al darb, where he responded to Ibn Hazm in Sara' al Hadithia, in a hadith way. If you want, you can find it there, inshallah. Ta'ala.
My second question about the same hadith is that Imam al Bukhari, rahimahullah, he actually placed this hadith in the chapter of those who seek permissibility of drinking alcohol by calling it other names. Now, he's not mentioned music. He's not mentioned anything like what you're trying to understand from this hadith. Yeah. And just like you say about the companions many times, if we trust Bukhari to narrate the hadith to us, we should also trust him with his understanding. He's not understood what you've understood from this, clearly, because he's put it in a chapter of drinks.
No, just first of all, Bukhari didn't say this hadith does not show the impermissibility of music. He didn't say that. Your point is only the fact that he mentioned it. Your question should be, why did he put it under the chaptering of the people who will name Khamar other than its name? Yeah. Why did he choose to put it there? Bukhari does that for many, many reasons. And the concept of the issue of Al-Imam al-Bukhari's chaptering is a science itself. There's a 10-volume book written by Abdul Haq al-Hashimi on just the chaptering of Bukhari and how he looks for the correlation between the hadith and also the bab, the chaptering. Somebody can flip the table on you and say to you, what about the hadith innama al-a'malu binniyat? That's the first hadith that Bukhari narrated. And it's talking about the intention. And he brought it under the chaptering of Kitab al-Badr al-Wahi. And he brings it in that section where the descending of the revelation. What does innama al-a'malu binniyat have to do with the descending of the revelation?
Okay.
But he did it for does it mean that Bukhari doesn't believe that the actions are based on the intention? Is that what we're going to derive from that? No.
Fine. Okay.
Rather, he narrated the hadith, of course, seven other places as well in his Sahih. But what I mean is that the chaptering of Bukhari does not support your point. It just shows that he chose to use it for something else.
Okay. Okay. Then the next question that I have on this particular hadith, Hisham ibn Ammar, who you've also mentioned in the chain. This is a person who a lot of scholars of hadith have weakened.
Such as
Imam al-Dhahabi, for example.
What did he say about him?
Imam al-Dhahabi said, so first of all, he mentioned him in Mizan al-Itidal.
What did he say?
So, and that's a book. What is that book, first of all? That book is where he mentions weak narrators, right?
Yeah, he speaks about narrators.
Okay, and he speaks about him in this book.
He grades the narrators over there.
Okay, he says, Hisham ibn Ammar used to be a truthful narrator, but then he changed. He has narrated 400 hadiths that have no basis. He used to not narrate unless someone paid him. He was accused of changing the text. Imam Ahmed said he was reckless.
So let's go bit by bit. So you said Dhahabi mentioned in Mizan al-Itidal.
Yeah, correct.
Just as a side benefit for the talabatul ilm and the students of knowledge, who inshallah ta'ala, the kitab Mizan al-Itidal by al-Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah shamsuddin al-Dhahabi, Ibn Hajar came after him. And he wrote a kitab called Lisan al-Mizan. And the Lisan al-Mizan is written by Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. And the reason why he wrote it is that he wanted to come after Ibn Dhahabi and basically correct him in some of the mistakes he might have fallen into in his Mizan al-I'tidal. That's a side benefit. So when a student is reading Mizan al-I'tidal, he must go back to Lisan al-Mizan by Ibn Hajar. Ibn Hajar has, mashallah, taqibat. very beneficial taqibat and points, especially if you have the taqiq of Sheikh Abdullah Abdi Fattah Abu Ghudda. Abdi Fattah Abu Ghudda, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala forgive him for his mistakes and his shortcomings. He was an Ash'ari, may Allah forgive him for his shortcomings, but truly was a scholar, alim haqiqatan, especially in ilm al-hadith. The points that Abdi Fattah Abu Ghudda rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a puts on the lisan al-mizan, it's amazing. So that's a side benefit for the students of knowledge. Now let's come back to Dhahabi. Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala has a statement of his in his kitab Sir Alam Nubala regarding Hisham ibn Ammar, and he calls him, he says Hisham ibn Ammar ibn Nusayr ibn Maysarata ibn Abani al-Imam al-Hafidh al-Allamah al-Muqri alim ahli Sham, he calls him.
Yeah, he also said he was a truthful narrator so before, now, but then he changed.
This concept of Hisham ibn Ammar changing when he grew older, and the statement that was said about him, I want to come back to it. Who really came from? It came from Abu Hatim al-Razi. I'm going to come to that inshallah ta'ala. But there's a statement Al-Khalili mentions in his kitab al-Irshad في معرفة علماء الحديث. He mentions Hisham ibn Ammar al-Dimashqi, he said ثقة وربما يقع في حديثه غرائب. Sometimes it may happen that in his hadith some strange things happen. And شيوخ الشام, from the teachers of Sham. فضعفه, he says, the weakness يقع من شيوخ لا منه. The mistakes that people see is not him. It's the mistakes that happen from his shuyukhs. He's quoting from them, right?
Yeah, yeah.
They made mistakes about the hadith.
So how do we know that this hadith isn't from them?
We're going to come to that, inshallah ta'ala. We're going to come to it. Okay? So that's the first point. Yahya ibn Ma'in said about him, thiqqatun. And Imam al-Bukhari authenticated him because he brought him in. He's sahih.
Mm-hmm.
And the scholars, they mentioned the ruwat, the narrators that are mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari. The scholars mentioned this, ulama al-hadith, they mentioned this generally speaking. The scholars that are mentioned by Bukhari in his sahih, they say jawaz al-qantara. They have passed the qantara. The qantara is after the person goes on the sirat yawmul qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us pass that path. The ayah, وَإِن مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا كَانَ عَلَى رَبِّكَ حَتْمًا مَقْضِيًّا ثُمَّ نُنَجِّي الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا وَنَذَرُ الظَّالِمِينَ فِيهَا جِثِيًّا. The people Allah is going to save are the pious people that they only. When the person passes that place, they go to a place called the Qantara, where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, وَنَزَعْنَا مَا فِي صُدُورِهِمْ مِنْ غِلٍّ إِخْوَانًا عَلَى صُرُورٍ مُتَقَابِلِينَ. The brothers who had hate and animosity for one another, that's the place that everybody will get their rights. Once you get to the Qantara, there's only Jannah for you. So they say that Bukhari, the people he brought in his narration, جَاوَزْ الْقَنْطَرَةِ, they're safe, you can't be criticized. Just give you two examples. Let's take Hushaym ibn Bashir. Hushaym ibn Bashir narrate, he's a strong scholar in hadith, right? Hushaym ibn Bashir, if he narrates from an Imam Muhammad ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, his hadiths are not accepted by Bukhari. But he will narrate it from other people.
Right.
Bukhari is a science. Bukhari is a science. It took 16 years of Ibn Hajar to understand the ins and outs of Sahih Bukhari. 16 years, that's why he wrote the two volume, the Muqaddimah Fathul Bari. We called it Hadyu Sari, Aba Huda Sari, say it both ways. Hushaym ibn Bashir, when he narrates from Zuhri, Bukhari would avoid him. Why? Because Hushaym ibn Bashir, the day in which he took the hadith from Zuhri, the day where he went to Zuhri and he took the hadith from him, it was a windy day. It was a windy day. And he wrote everything and it was a windy day and the papers, they went into the air. And what happened was Hushaym ibn Bashir tried to take the papers back. But of course, the notes went back and forward. He didn't memorize it. He avoided taking those narrations from him. But if you find him, Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i, for example.
If you find him, you didn't finish that. If you find him?
If you find him in Sahih al-Bukhari, he avoided.
Okay, it's a different route.
He avoided him through Zuhri. Okay. Another example is Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i. Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i, Bukhari narrated from him. And his narrations of Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Bukhari never narrates from him. But his narrations from Sufyan al-Thawri and his narration from Shu'bah ibn Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki, the narrations are accepted. Because Yahya ibn Ma'in said, he's the strongest when it comes to the narrations of who? Shu'bah ibn Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki, and the narrations of who? Sufyan al-Thawri. Bukhari narrates from those two. But he doesn't accept the narrations of him when it comes to Sufyan ibn Uyayna. The point I'm trying to say to you is that Even if criticism were put towards Hisham ibn Ammar, we will say his narrations, Bukhari selected them. That's a side point that you always need to remember. If you find a narrator that's criticized, which is in Sahih Bukhari, Bukhari picked him from all of his mistakes to versions which were right. He does that, rahimahullah. That's very important. But here, I'm arguing that he's a thiqah, Hisham ibn Ammar. He's a thiqah. Ahmad al-Ajli, he said, Hisham ibn Ammar al-Damashqi, thiqatun suduq. Al-Imam al-Nasai, rahimahullah, praised him. Dar-Qutni, Imam al-Ilal. By the way, Dar-Qutni, he has a kitab called Ilal al-Warida. They said, Amlahu min dhahrihi. And Amlahu min hifdhihi. He narrated the whole entire 10 something volumes. Yani from memory. Al-Dhahabi, I think it was him. He said that if it's true, I think it was Imam al-Dhahabi. He said, if it's true that Dar-Qutni dictated this book from memory, then he's no less than Ahmed Muhammad and Abu Zur'at al-Razi and Abu Amatim al-Razi. By the way, they said about Dar-Qutni as a side benefit. They said about him, subhanAllah, they said about him, he would yani put things in his ears when he walked outside because okay. He would memorize people's conversations.
Oh, his memory was that sharp.
There was a strange story that was mentioned about him, Dar-Qutni. This is a side point.
Yeah.
They said that two men were arguing and they were speaking a different language.
Okay.
And he saw the argument going back and forth and he had his yani, cotton wool in his ears. He chose to take it out and came to the two people. And he said, what is the problem? What's the quarrel that you guys are having? And they told him their problems. Later, both of them went. And they went to the court to argue. The court said, well, who's your witness in this situation? They said that Dar-Qutni is our yani shahid witness. He was there. He was present when we were both arguing. He was there. Keeping in mind that Dar-Qutni, they were quarreling and they were arguing in two different languages. So he came to the courtroom and the judge asked Dar-Qutni, is it true that you were present when these two people were arguing over an issue? He said, yes. What did they say to each other? He said they spoke different language. Both of them were speaking two different languages. I don't know what they said, but I memorized it. He quoted this first man what he said. He quoted the second one what he said. And he kept the information for them intact. Passed it on. The Qadi said, we know what he meant, what happened.
Allahu Akbar.
Gave the judgment to this. So Dar-Qutni, rahimahullah ta'ala, they said his hifdh was thaqib, yani strong, solid. Rahimahullah. He said, suduqun kabirul mahal. And this man, he said, Hisham al-Ammar, he said he's a reliable person. And he said, kabirul mahal. Okay, he said he's a high position, a high station. Even Dhahabi's kalam that you mentioned.
Yeah, this statement then. Because very different.
When you go back to Mizan al-I'tidal, you find that there has next to it, Saad Ha.
But did Dhahabi mention all this for his narrated 400 hadiths have no basis? He used to not narrate unless someone paid him. This is different from... And I don't have the
reference. I'm going to come to that, inshallah ta'ala, issue. But what I want to mention is that he mentions al-Imam al-Dhahabi in his Mizan al-I'tidal, the fourth volume, page 302.
Mm-hmm.
He mentions, Dhahabi mentions, Saad Ha.
Which means?
We have to now go to Lisan al-Mizan. Look at what does that mean? It's a rams, it's a sign. What does that mean? Ibn Hajar mentions, because he knows Dhahabi, he studied Dhahabi. That's what he's working on. Lisan al-Mizan is working on the kitab al-Mizan al-I'tidal by Dhahabi. He says, if Saad Ha is written before the name, فهي إشارة إلى أن العمل على توثيق ذلك الرجل. Dhahabi is saying, if Saad Ha is written, then that means that person's hadith are authentic and it's acted upon.
Okay.
Okay? So that's Dhahabi what he said. Also, half of the Mughlatai in his kitab, Ikmal al-Tahdhib al-Kamal, he says, قال السخاوي في جمال القراء. He mentions Hisham with ثقة أمين عند أئمة الحديث. Suyuti mentions it. And scholars of hadith, even Dhahabi rahimahullah mentions that he's a رأساً في الكتاب والسنة. Now, there is a shubha, a doubt that's brought forward regarding Hisham ibn Ammar, that Ahmed ibn Hanbal said something about him. That he said, طياشٌ خفيف. You have that quote? You mentioned, I think.
Yeah, he was reckless.
Yeah. That statement was attributed to Ahmed ibn Hanbal.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and the scholars have mentioned why he said it. Okay, they mention why he mentioned it. Dhahabi specifically mentions it, rahimahullah ta'ala. He says, "Amma qawlu al-imami, yani Ahmed." He said, "Tayyashun, falianahu balagahu anhu annahu qala fi khutbati." It was Ahmed, it reached him that he said about it. That Hisham al-Ammar said in his khutbah, "Alhamdulillah, alladhi tajalla li khalqihi bi khalqihi." The one who became apparent to his creation with his creation. So this kalam, فهذه الكلمة لا ينبغي إطلاقها. The statement Dhahabi says it's not permissible to just say it like that. وإن كان له معنى صحيح, even though it has a correct meaning, لكن يحتج بها الحلولي والاتحادي. The حلولي, the one who, the pantheism, the one who believes Allah and His creation, yeah, and He became one, they use these kind of statements. So when Ahmed was told that statement, in that context, he said, طياشٌ خفيف. And look what Dhahabi said after that. He said, وبكل حال, whatever the situation is, كلام الأقران بعضهم في بعض يحتمل. Statements of contemporaries, peers, يعني يطوى ولا يروى. يطوى ولا يروى. يعني we mention it. يعني that's what Dhahabi was saying. About Ahmed's statement. So Hisham ibn Ammar is an Imam Bukhari rahimahullah chose him. As for the statement that Abu Hatim al-Razi mentioned that his hifd changed, then I unequivocally differ with that, because al-Imam Hisham ibn Ammar, his ahadith are very well known. يعني we have many chains of narration that they go into, but the way I'm going to respond to this is the following way. Number one, Hisham ibn Ammar, his hadith are known very well. They are known what? Very well. Abu Walid al-Baji mentions that Hisham ibn Ammar, he gave his ahadiths to Yahya ibn Ma'in and Abu Ubaid Qasim al-Salam. And they looked at it. And they observed these narrations. He had it in a book. That's where he narrates from. Well, the scholars, they write it and they memorize it from their notes. All of the narrations that Hisham ibn Ammar writ, Yahya ibn Ma'in and Abu Ubaid Qasim al-Salam, both of them looked at it. And Hisham mentioned, Nadhar ibn Ma'in fi hadithi, he looked at my hadith, all of it, except the hadith of Suwayd ibn Abdul Aziz. And then he said to me, Suwayd is da'if al-hadith. That's one. So the hadiths of Hisham ibn Ammar are well known. Yani, it's sahih. That's number one. The second response is, Bukhari took from him before him, قبل التغير, before he even changed. Bukhari took it from me before he changed. And the evidence to that is that Bukhari mentioned that he traveled. لقيت أكثر من أهل من ألف رجل أهل الحجاز والعراق والشام ومصر. We mentioned that in our refutation of the Ash'ara. He mentioned that he went to many places. He mentioned he went to Basra 4 times. He went to Hijaz 6 times. He mentions, يعني, how many times I entered Kufa, I don't know, وبغداد, I mentioned. And then here he mentions وبالشام. And I went to Sham. By the way, Hisham ibn Ammar is from the ulama Sham.
Okay.
So Bukhari says, I went to Sham and I met Al-Firyabiyu, Aba Mishar, Aba Al-Mughira, Aba Al-Yaman. I met these people and many other people. If we look at the time of Firyabi, Firyabi died 212. Abu Mishar al-Dimashqi died, who is the Sheikh of Sham. He died the year 218 Hijriah. That shows that Bukhari
was there before then.
He went to Sham to hear from the Shuyukhs of Sham before the year of 212, at least, because Firyabi was the earliest one who died. And that's before the death of Hisham ibn Ammar, 40 years before that.
When did Hisham ibn Ammar change, though?
See, the call of, what's his name, Abu Hatim al-Razi, is that he mixed up in his last stages of his life. 40 years cannot be considered last stage of a person's life. That's a long time.
Okay.
And the scholars, they mentioned he mixed up just before he passed away. That's the ones who mentioned it. So that's that one. The third one is that you have to understand, is that, akhi, you have to really understand, is Abu Ja'far al-Uqayli, he said, when Bukhari wrote his Sahih, who did he present it to? He presented to Ali ibn al-Madini and Ahmed ibn Hanbal and Yahya ibn Ma'in. You have to understand this. Sahih al-Bukhari was presented to who?
The scholars of Hadith.
Abu Ja'far al-Uqayli is saying this. That the Imam al-Bukhari, when he wrote his Sahih, he went to Ali ibn al-Madini, said, check my book. When Ali ibn al-Madini checked it, by the way, Ali ibn al-Madini is the one that Bukhari said, istasqartu nafsi, I belittle myself in the presence of this man. And also, Imam al-Bukhari presented to Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and he presented to Yahya ibn Ma'in. So what does that show you? These three men have agreed to this hadith of Hisham ibn Ammar as well, of Bukhari in his Sahih. Okay? They all affirmed it. So this shows you that this kitab that Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala wrote is, yani, this hadith is accepted by the Aimatul Hadith, the ones who don't want to take this hadith, because this hadith, if it becomes sahih, it is sarih.
We're going to talk about that, definitely. So I'm getting from that what you mean is that this is directly, clearly, categorically stating that music is haram, which is strange because having gone through the narrators, and I can comfortably say that you've dismissed a lot of the arguments brought forward for that, from the text of the hadith itself, and again, it might be worth, because it's been a while since you narrated the hadith, re-narrating the hadith and telling me what you understand from this hadith.
So the hadith, we have the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioning, لا يكونن it will be من أمتي from my people أقوام a people. يعني there's going to be from amongst my ummah a people يستحلون الحرى والحريرة والخمرة والمعازف. There's going to be a people who are going to permit for themselves the following: الحرى زنا, الحريرة silk, الخمرة alcohol, and المعازف music.
Okay.
So in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned khamr, which is haram by unanimous agreement, zina, which is haram by unanimous agreement, and al-harir, which is prohibited for the men by unanimous agreement. So we have all of that. And then on top of that, the ma'azif, the music, was mentioned in this context. Yani this is something very well known in usul al-fiqh called dalaalatu al-iqtiraan,
which is, as you, I'm sure you know, dalaalatu al-iqtiraan is not a very strong argument in usul al-fiqh. And a lot of the scholars of usul, they actually say this is very, very weak to use this as a proof. And one of the reasons they say that is because the whole issue is connecting certain things and saying when it's brought together in one manner, in one statement, then they all take the same meaning. Now, there's a problem here because there's an ayah in the Qur'an which does something very, very similar, yet the two things that are connected have different meanings. The ayah, I've got it here. كُلُوا مِن ثَمَرِهِ إِذَا أَثْمَرَ وَآتُوا حَقَّهُ يَوْمَ حَصَادِهِ. Allah says in this ayah, eat from the fruits when they harvest, and then pay its right, which is the zakat, obviously, here, on the day that they harvest. Mm-hmm. Now, we have an issue here because according to you, because these two things are mentioned together, the ruling on both of these things must be the same. Mm-hmm. Yet we know, and I'm sure you'll agree, that eating is something that's permissible. It's not wajib, it's not haram, it's eating is permissible. Yet paying zakat is something that is obligatory. So Allah is connecting two things here, something that is permissible and something that is obligatory, which completely refutes your claim that every time some things are connected, they must all take the same ruling, like in this hadith that you're claiming.
So you're taking me to an issue in usul al-fiqh known as dalalatul iqtiran. Now, dalalatul iqtiran, according to ulama, usul al-fiqh is two types. Okay, you put a good argument, to be honest, and it's a strong point. Dalalatul iqtiran is two types, right? The first type is what the scholars refer to as dalalatul iqtiran, which is tam. Ama dalalatul iqtiran, which is yani naqis, those two. It's either tam or naqis.
Okay.
In another way, the scholars refer to is dalalatul iqtiran, which is ama atful mufradat, ama or the second type, which is atful al jumal, ama atful jumla. Atful jumla, atful mufradat, and atful jumla. What does that mean?
Okay.
The ayah that you brought right now, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, in Surah Al-An'am, ayah 141, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He says, كُلُوا مِن ثَمَرِهِ إِذَا أَثْمَرَ. That's one sentence.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next part is, if we take the waw out, آتُ حَقَّهُ يَوْمَ حَصَادِهِ, which is the second sentence. Allah connected two sentences between it, a waw.
Okay.
This one, it's two jumlataini tamataini.
Two complete sentences.
Yeah. Here we have two jumlataini tamataini. Two sentences which are both complete. We have mubtada and a khabar, or a fi'il and a fa'il. That's a complete sentence in Arabic language. We have kulu min thamarihi idha athmara is a sentence. Then Allah says, wa atu haqqahu yawma hasadi, which is another sentence. Now, here, you're right. If that happens, that type, which is atful wawi bayna jumlataini tammataini, this one, according to the ulama, this one has, we can't connect them all in ruling. Because we say, kulu min thamarihi idha athmara is mubah, atu haqqahu yawma hasadih is a what? Wajib. Which is zakatul mafruza, is the obligatory zakat is referring to here. You're right. In this situation, they don't have the same ruling. But the second type is where we're talking about, which is dalaalatu al-iqtiraan, which is atful mufradat. What does atful mufradat mean? Atful mufradat means Zainab, Mu'addaba wa Fatima. Zainab is disciplined, well-mannered, and Fatima. Now, Zainab, Mu'addaba. This is two words. And it's a complete sentence, right? Zainab, Mu'addaba.
Yeah.
If you took that out, well, Fatima can't stand by itself. It's one word.
It doesn't make sense.
It's atful mufradat. It's one word. So Fatima here is connected to Mu'addaba, disciplined. This one, according to the ulama of usul, by unanimous agreement, this one is, yani, it is accepted. And to them, this one is not like the ayah, kulu min thamarihi idha athmara. Scholars agree upon this. This is called atful mufradat. Zarkashi mentions it in his Bahrul Muhit. He says, amma idha kana al-ma'tufu naqisan. Sometimes the scholars, they call it atful naqis, because it's naqis.
It's deficient.
It's deficient. It's not a complete sentence by itself. Or they call it atful mufradat. This one, the scholars, he says, amma idha kana al-atfu naqisan, he says, فَلَا خِلَافَ فِي مُشَارَكَتِهِ لِلْأَوَّلِ. There's no dispute amongst the scholars that it goes under the same ruling as the other one.
Right, I see. So when the scholars say that دَلَالَةُ الْإِقْتِرَانِ is مُخْتَلَفٌ فِي, they're actually talking about the first type, which is connecting sentences and not individual words.
Yeah, if they're two جُمْلَتَيْنِ تَامَتَيْنِ, then the جُمْلَ أُولَى and the جُمْلَ ثَانِي don't necessarily have to be connected to each other. That's something. Also, عَلَى أُدِينَ الْبُخَارِ in his kitab كَشْفُ الْأَسْرَارِ, which is a sharh of usul al-bazdawi, he mentions the same. He says, he said, إِذَا كَانَ نَاقِسًا, if it's naqis, يُشَارِكُ الْجُمْلَةَ الْمَعْطُوفَ عَلَيْهَا فِي خَبَرِي وَحُكْمِهِ جَمِيعًا. The same. Sadr al-Sharia, Ibn Mas'ud al-Bukhari, in his kitab Tawdihu li-Matn Tanqih, he mentions it. Shihabuddin al-Qarafi, in his kitab Nafais al-Usul, I mentioned four imams, they mentioned it. Rather, al-Qarafi, in his kitab Nafais al-Usul, he says, نَصَّ النُّحَاتِ, the grammarians have stated as well, على أن المعطوف يجب مشاركة للمعطوف عليه في أصل الحكم الذي سيق الكلام لأجله فيقع الاشتراك في أصل التحريم.
It's important to translate some of that.
So what it is that they, if it's عطف المفردات, he's saying it's obligatory by the, according to the grammarians, and it's also according to the
if it's connecting words. If it's connecting words, individual words, then whatever the hukm, whatever the ruling goes on the first word, for example, it takes a ruling for the other words as well. That's
if
it's what just you're
yeah, if the word can't stand by itself as a sentence.
Okay.
In the situation here, let's apply on the hadith. The hadith says, "La yakunanna min ummati aqwam yastahillun al-hira wal-harira wal-khamra wal-ma'azi." So we have yastahilluna.
Okay.
They make permissible al-hira.
Okay.
That's the word. Yastahillun al-hira.
Okay.
And the other ones are connected to it.
Well, so that in itself is a complete sentence, but the other ones they stand alone.
Ah, so you have. So can you say لا يكونن من أمتي أقوام الحريرة والخمرة والمعازف? It's not a sentence. You need the other sentence.
Okay.
Can't stand by itself.
Okay.
So according to the ulama, دلالة الإقتران, which is المفردات, توجب اشتراك واتحاد المعطوفات في الحكم الشرعي. They have to always be under the same ruling.
So according to that principle that you just mentioned, then one of the things that was mentioned in that hadith, like you said, was silk. And you rightly said that silk is haram for men, but permissible for women. So by that token, then music is haram for men, but also permissible for women.
No, you can't say that. How do you know silk is haram for men?
From the hadith in Sunnah of Ibn Majah.
So you dandy an exception for the women with an external evidence.
I'm just using your principle alone. You said that when things are connected like this, they take all the same ruling.
Yeah, they do. According
but
to this hadith
but
by
they
itself.
They have different rulings.
But you only found out that there's a different ruling for silk with an external evidence. If there came an external evidence that said music for the men is allowed or not allowed and it's permissible for women music, then we would say, okay, you're right. You brought external evidence just like you brought for the silk.
Right, I see. The asal of the hadith originally
both.
Is that everything is haram
for men and women.
But then we have an external evidence say there's an exception for
the silk. If this hadith was the only hadith out there, we would say to women, you're not allowed to wear silk.
Uh-huh.
Like in the hadith that permits silk for women is when the Prophet ﷺ grabbed it and he picked it with one hand with his left and his right and he said, this has been made haram for the male of my ummah, the gold and the silk. He picked them both up and the Prophet ﷺ, he said, this has been made haram for dhukur ummati, the men of my ummah. So you know that silk for men is haram with an external evidence, but merely just this hadith by itself, it's not the case.
Okay, and there is another contention that people bring with the understanding of this hadith when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is connecting all of these things together. And they say that some things might be okay and permissible individually, but when you connect them together and you do them at the same time, it becomes impermissible. So for example, even though it's a secular law, let's take the UK law for example, driving is permissible and drinking alcohol is permissible. But when you do them, according to law, obviously, the secular law of the UK, when you do them together, drinking and driving, it's not permissible. And that's basically what they're saying with this hadith. And the reason why they say that is because there's another narration in the Sunan of Ibn Majah, which also makes this clear. So the hadith that you're mentioning is that there will be people who will consider it to be legal, zina, wearing silk, khamar, and music. Okay, it's like what they're claiming here basically is that the Prophet is describing a scene where people are drinking and the people are wearing silk and they're listening to music and they're committing zina. This is like the party scenes, quote unquote, that we have in the modern day world in clubs and stuff like that. What the Prophet here is saying that when all of these things come together, he's not actually individually saying this is haram, this haram, and this haram, but rather he's describing a scene, a scenario. And the reason they say that is because the hadith in Sunan Ibn Majah, and you can have a look at it here, it says it's a very similar situation. What the Prophet ﷺ said is narrated by Abu Malik Ash'ari, people among my nation will drink wine, calling it by another name, so far exactly the same, and musical instruments will be played for them and singing girls will sing for them. Allah will cause the earth to swallow them up and turn them into monkeys and pigs. What he's basically describing a scene, people are drinking wine and at the same time music is being played. He's not saying individually these acts are prohibited, but when you bring them together, they become prohibited.
I mean, again, I think that's far-fetched. What about the ayah, for example? Let me flip that at you. Okay. I'm saying you're wrong in that understanding.
Okay.
Each one independently is what Allah is going to destroy the people for. Even the hadith Tirmidhi narrated it. Also Ibn Abi Dunya narrated it in Dhammul Malahi. Ibn Abi Shayba narrated it on the authority of Imran ibn Husaynin, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَكُونُ فِي أُمَّتِي قَذْفٌ وَمَسْخٌ وَخَسْفٌ. He said, Ya Rasulullah, when is this going to be? He said, إِذَا ظَهْرَتِ الْمَعَازِفُ وَكَثُرَتِ الْقِيَانُ وَشُرِبَتِ الْخُمُورُ. If people start to consume alcohol and they get qiyanu. Qiyanu is jam'u qaynatin. Qaynatin is women who sing for them. If they start listening to music, musical instruments, the Prophet then sallallahu alaihi wasallam said Allah is going to deform them. There's going to be earth is going to swallow them. This you're saying that all of it has to happen in order for the punishment to come, right?
Yeah.
What about the statement of Allah? وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرَ وَلَا يَقْتُلُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَلَا يَزْنُونَ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ يَلْقَ أَثَامًا. Allah mentioned a punishment, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that it's severe punishment is for these people. Are you saying that a person has to do shirk and kill someone innocent and commit zina, that's when they're going to get the sin? Do you understand my point?
Yeah, of course, nobody would say that.
No one would say that. Everybody would say independently you get sin for doing it. If you do shirk alone, itself is a great, great sin. If you kill innocent people, it's or a person, itself is a great sin. If committing zina or fornication or adultery, itself is a great sin. So independently, it's a sin. It's the same as the ayah also. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَمَن يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِن بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ السَّبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Anyone who opposes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that itself is a sin, and then opposes the path of the believers, it's also a second sin. And the more you do, if you do all of it, you're subhanallah, you're the worst. One by itself can render you a criminal. One by itself can render you a wrongdoer, a sinner. Yeah. They all don't have to be found.
Final question I have in this hadith, because I know this is one of the most strongest proof on the side of those who say that obviously music is haram. Final question I have on that is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said at the start of hadith ummati, he's talking about the Muslims, right? Yet we know that if someone makes khamar, for example, halal, this is istikhlal, which you said in a previous podcast is kufr, which is disbelief. So how do you reconcile the fact that it's an action of disbelief, yet the Prophet still said my ummah?
Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah has a very good response to this. He's got a kitab called Bayan al-Dalil fi Butlan al-Tahlil, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. And on the 20th page, he says, رحمه الله تعالى لعل الاستحلال المذكور في الحديث إنما يكون بالتأويلات الفاسدة، فإنهم لو استحلوها مع اعتقاد أن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم حرمها كانوا كفارا ولم يكونوا من أمتي، ولو كانوا معترفين بأنها حرام لأوشك أن لا يعاقبوا بالمسح كسائر الذين لم يزالوا يفعلون هذه المعاصي. The point Ibn Taymiyyah points out here, rahimahullah ta'ala, is he says that istihlal here in the hadith is referring to they use interpretations, which we saw today. We can in the hadith because of Hisham ibn Ammar saying that the dalaalatu al-iqtiraan is not a hujjah. Wahakada. These ta'wilat al-fasida that was used by Ibn Hazm, by also used by Shawkani. That's what has happened here. Because of that, they are going to be sinners, and not because they're kufar. They would have been kufar if they saw it to be haram and then they said it's still halal for me, I don't care. That's when it would be kufrun billahi al-aliyyul azim, from the statement of Ibn Taymiyyah. He says, فَإِنَّهُمْ لَوْ إِسْتَحَلُّوهَا مَعْ اعْتِقَادِ أَنَّ الرَّسُولَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ حَرَّمَهَا كَانُوا كُفَارًا. Then they would become kufar. وَلَمْ يَكُونُوا مِنْ أُمَّتِي, and they won't be from his ummah. But if they say that, no, I don't even believe أصل الحكم in the first place, I believe this is not actually haram, it's not clear, then they become sinners. And if people fall into major sins and they are going against Allah and His Messenger, and it's very dangerous. Okay. And then he brings the statement of the poet Abdullah ibn Mubarak, what he said, وَهَلْ أَفْسَدَ الدِّينَ إِلَّا الْمُلُوكُ وَأَحْبَارُ سُوءٍ وَرُهُبَانُ. يعني the people, you see, they've taken يعني evil scholars who've told them this is permissible and gave them fatwa. So it's not kufr, but it's a major, major sin now.
Fine. I want to put the hadith to one side. I think we've comprehensively gone through the chain, first of all, and then secondly, we've gone through the text of the hadith itself as well. Give me like a 30-second, 1 minute summary of that hadith and what that really, really shows for the people at home before we move on to the rest of the point.
The hadith of
the one we just discussed, in the one about the istihlal. And
this hadith shows the severity of the person who يعني commits zina, and who يعني the male who take silk and you wear it and use it, and those who drink khamar and music. Each one, if we look into it by itself, for example, al-hira, which is zina. We know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, when I was ascended high up in the sky, I saw a group of people who were being burnished in a furnace. These were the zunnat, when the Prophet was told, alayhi salatu wasalam, this, the people were doing zina, al-hira. Now we have the yani the khamar, the ones who drink alcohol and are consumers of alcohol. Yani the prohibition that has come regarding them. إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام رجس من عمل الشيطان فاجتنبوه. It's the actions of shaitan. Knowing that music that you're listening to and that you're adorning and you're admiring has been mentioned with things like that, first of all, your heart should move and say, ooh, يعني zina. And because a lot of people who are watching today will be like, whoa, I mean, I know zina al-haram. Even if I do it, I still know it's haram.
And same with alcohol as well.
Yeah, I don't justify it. Even the ones who drink alcohol will say, bro, I know it's wrong, man. You know, I can't stop it. I've become used to it. My culture, my people, we do this, and etc. So the same thing should be for the music. Of course, know its prohibition and also try to stay away from it. Another thing is the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us in the hadith itself, وَلَيَنْزِلَنَّ أَقْوَامٌ إِلَى جَنْبِ عَلَمٍ يَرُوحُ عَلَيْهِمْ بِسَارِحَةٍ لَهُمْ. There's a punishment for these people, and that is Allah is going to deform them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I actually believe a lot of these rappers and these singers, Allah has deformed them already.
What do you mean by that?
Look at the way they scream and they shout and they bark, yani jump on the table, running around, yani things when you really sit down and you think to yourself, subhanallah, yaakhi, subhanallah, this is not sane. A man whose trousers is falling down, yani you can see his backside, this is not a sane person. Sane person wears his clothes. A man whose name is Dog, he calls himself an animal, the worst of animals, dogs. Yani, this is, you can see Allah has already humiliated him, put him down. And a lot of them, they make noises of dogs when they sing, and etc. So the actual changing of their form, it's not far-fetched.
Okay. I want to move on now. I want to go back to the ayah in the Quran that you mentioned, where you said, lahu al-hadith, and you gave the interpretations of the companions, the tabi'in, who said that this refers to music. And I really want to focus now on the adilla from the Quran. If that isn't enough, if this hadith in and of itself isn't enough for people, and they say we need something from the Quran, for example, the first question I have about this particular ayah that you brought, when you said lahu al-hadith, is talking about music. Isn't there another ayah in Surah Al-Jum'ah But Allah says, وَإِذَا رَأَوْ تِجَارَةً أَوْ لَهْوَنٍ فَضُّوا إِلَيْهَا انْفَضُّوا إِلَيْهَا وَتَرَكُوكَ قَائِمًا. Allah says that in this ayah, that when the companions actually left the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in prayer to attend to trade, and he also uses the word lahu here as well, the same word you're using. Sahih. Are you saying that this means music, and in which case the companions ran towards music and ran towards business? Allah connected the two together, tijara and lahu, and according to you, tijara is permissible. Mm-hmm. Therefore, music must also be permissible.
No, the first of all, the argument I want you to understand is that وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهُوَ الْحَدِيثِ. The scholars that commented on it, like Ibn Abbas, is the one who explained this ayah in Surah Al-Jum'ah in this way, and explained this surah to me in this way. And it's very important we understand it. These are Arabs. Mm. They are not just Arabs. They're the most honest and the most sincere and the most knowledgeable people that we know in our ummah. Ashabu Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They looked at these verses and they commented on, not based on their whims and desires, but based on. وَلِذَلِكَ some of the scholars, like Al-Imam Al-Hakim and Naysaburi and other great scholars, I don't want to go into that too much, they believe the tafsir of a sahabi on a verse, لَهُ حُكْمُ الرَّفْعِ. It's like the Prophet said it, alayhi salatu wasalam. It's another discussion for another time. عَلَى كُلِّن. Here we have, now, it doesn't contradict itself if the word لَهُ الْحَدِيثِ has many meanings.
Okay.
There's no denying that it could be a word that has many meanings. It could be used in many different like.
So your claim is not that it only means music. That's not your claim.
That's not my claim. And that would then your point and your contention would be very solid and strong against me if I only said lahu al-hadith only means music. I'm saying no.
Right.
And they'll stay and I mentioned before, that's called ikhtilafu tanawwu.
Yeah, you did. Okay. Any other ayat from the Quran that you want to bring on your side, for example?
There are many. I said five verses. Show one of them is Surah Al-Najm, when Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says, وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ.
What does that mean?
The word Samid, Ibn Abbas, Samidun, Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, the word Samidun, it is al-ghina bil-himyariya. It is, it means, the word Samidun actually means music in the language and the dialect of the people of Himyar.
So what's the context of this? Because you just said, وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ, you guys are. You
Samidun.
Are, yeah, what came before it?
أَفَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ.
Meaning in English?
فَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ, are you amazed with these يعني, hadith, this discussion, this speech?
Okay.
Are you amazed with it? فَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ وَتَضْحَكُونَ, are you laughing? وَلَا تَبْكُونَ, you're not crying. وَتَضْحَكُونَ وَلَا تَبْكُونَ وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ, whilst you are listening to يعني, music.
Okay.
So here the word الغنى, according to Ibn Abbas, sorry, سَامِدُونَ, according to Ibn Abbas رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said that the word وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ is referring to al-ghina according to bil-himyariya, in that language. It's a dialect. They say it like that. And the ayah, it used it. And that meaning, a'immatu tafsir took that view from Ibn Abbas, like Ikrima, Mujahid, Dhahak, Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, and others.
Don't you think that all of these ayat that are talking about these kind of situation is really talking not about music unrestrictedly, but it's talking about music when it's being used to, like, for example, the ayat of the Qur'an are coming and people are, I'll give you an example, let's just say the listening to podcasts. We'd both agree that listening to podcasts doesn't have any music, anything that's haram, is permissible, right?
I know.
But if someone was to listen to a podcast and the time for salah came and he's so consumed with listening to the podcast that he didn't want to pray and he left the salah, that's also obviously not permissible.
I know.
But another person just wants to listen to podcasts when he's driving into work, for example, and he's just listening to it just as entertainment. There's nothing wrong with that.
Mm-hmm.
So why do you have to say that music in all its forms and all its entirety is haram when these ayat are clearly talking about the time when music is being used to distract you from worshipping Allah?
The music that was listened to at that time, it was used to distract the people from the Quran and the remembrance of Allah. Yes, it did.
Okay, good. You admit that.
Of course, it did. It did distract.
That's the situation which it came in. Okay.
And I don't deny the fact that it's the case for us today as well. Today, that there's no denying to that. That many people today, a large amount of Muslims today, are listening to music, giving precedence to music over the Quran.
Yeah, that's true.
They've not memorized the Quran, but they've memorized albums and lyrics. That's well known, well established.
That's true, but it doesn't necessarily make it haram in of itself. Just like listening to podcasts over the Quran doesn't mean podcasts.
Now we go to the point of the fact that they used to do that with music. Mm. That's what they used to do. They used to listen to music and they used to try to avoid hearing the Quran.
Okay.
And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala unrestrictedly prohibited it when it became an act that was done to distract people from the remembrance of Allah, from the Qur'an, Allah prohibited. Mutlaqan. Whether you're trying to distract yourself from the Qur'an or not, it got prohibited. And it became something which is haram. So if someone comes after now and says, I'm not going to do what Quraysh did, or I'm not going to do the people that these verses came under, what they were doing, I'm not going to do that. We're going to say, now lakin, the hukm has been made. If it's music, if it's yani musical instrument, if it's songs, without the conditions that we mentioned, muharram.
Okay.
It's haram. The only ones that you can take out are what the points that we mentioned. Those are the istithna'at, the exceptions only. Anything other than those exceptions. And I want somebody to remember this. And a lot of people do this. It's sad. It's a sad reality, but a lot of people tend to do this. Okay? I, for example, say, everyone in this room go, except Zayd.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's the general ruling here?
That everyone should leave.
And the only person who can...
Zayd.
If Khalid comes up to me and says to me, shall I leave? I said, everyone leave. I gave a general ruling.
Yeah.
You fool. Was your name mentioned under the exception?
No.
Music and songs are haram. The Sharia has permitted situations, contexts, times, conditions, types. These we will not deny it. The Sharia permitted it. These ones fall under the general prohibition. Don't use these specific situations to headbutt and destroy the general ruling of the prohibition.
How big a problem do you think music is nowadays? How widespread is it in every country?
Wallahi, when you look at the Salaf, what they were saying about music, like Qur'an al-Shaytan and Ruqyat al-Shaytan and إِنَّهَا يُنْبِتُ فِي الْقَلْبِ النِّفَاقِ. Yeah, it brings hypocrisy in the heart. You're saying they didn't even know the music we're seeing today.
And the fact that it's so widespread as well, and how evil it is, and how widespread it is. You go into a supermarket, you can't help but hear it. You got this, it's going on the taxi, it's going everywhere. You'd agree with that, obviously.
I, subhanAllah, used to deal with brothers on the street who were trying to come off the streets, who want Allah to guide them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani they were on the streets and committed crimes, and some of them being imprisoned and whatnot. Wallahi, ka'anno is like as though it's a mahallu ijma' amongst all of them. They all said that whenever we would go and shoot up someone or stab someone or this or that or rob or this, we'd have to listen to yani music.
Mm-hmm.
And specifically a particular type of genre.
Yeah.
We'd listen to drill. If we listen to that music, we don't know what's happening around us.
Mm-hmm.
Yani just, we would go out there and stab someone. He says to you, wallahi, sometimes I wouldn't even have to take any drug substance. Just listen to that. And the lyrics and what he says, I'll go and I'll murder someone. I would, if not necessarily, I'll stab him and put him into coma or whatever. I would rob, I would this, I would that, all of it with music.
You said earlier that the Salaf obviously wouldn't, they didn't know that music was going to be like this, was going to end up like this. Did Allah know that it was going to end up like this?
That's why Allah generally prohibited it.
So Allah knew that it was going to end up like this. Of course Allah knows that, right?
Subhanahu wa
ta'ala. So then why isn't there a clear fi'al nahi, a clear, knowing that music is going to be such a big issue, it's going to be so widespread, it's going to cause so much harm, it's going to cause so much damage. When Allah talks about shirk, for example, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. When Allah talks about zina, he says, وَلَا تَقْرِبُ zina. Allah talks about murder, for example, وَلَا تَقْتُلُ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ
إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ.
إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. Allah has clear ayat telling you, don't do this, don't do this, don't go near this even. It's so clear, it's so sarih. Why didn't he do that with music, knowing that it was going to be as big a problem as it is in the 21st century?
Habibi, when you say it's not clear, it's clear to every sincere, genuine Muslim.
There's no fi'al nahi, would you agree with that? Forbidding verb.
Yeah, there is.
There is, which one?
There are many ayats that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala prohibited it.
Which said, one in that form?
وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورَ.
وَالَّذِينَ,
the ones, لَا يَشْهَدُونَ, they do not participate in الزُّورَ, in Zur. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, Mujahid ibn Jabrin, and other mufassirin, they said Zura here means music. What I mean, Habibi, is also واستفزز من استطعت منهم بصوتك وأجلب عليهم بخيلك ورجلك وشاركهم في الأموال والأولاد وعدهم وما يعدهم الشيطان إلا غرورا. واستفزز من استطعت منهم بصوتك, your voice. The مفسرين,
شيطان's voice,
the voice here, yes, Mujahid ibn Jabr, whose tafsir we like, إذا جاءك تفسير مجاهد فحسبك به, Ibn Jarir al-Tabri brought it, Abu Nu'aym brings it in his Hilya, Ibn al-Jawzi brings it in his Talbis al-Iblis, Qurtubi brings it in his tafsir, all of them, that the word as-sawt here means, that Mujahid says, يعني, it means music. So it's clear to anybody who's munsif, who's sincere, who's genuine, who now the truth has reached him, and when he sees those evidences, he's not going to argue back. He's going to be pleased with it. He's going to be, Ya Rab, I don't need 10, I don't need 5 evidences from the Quran for me to stay away from something. But one is enough for me.
But it's always like, the companion interpreted as this, the companion said this, the companion said, these were the great noble men, don't get me wrong.
But they weren't my Shahid, prophet. But Shahid, they're eyewitnesses. If there happened a car accident happened in front of us, we would be eyewitnesses. We saw it. The police would take our encounter of the situation. Somebody who came 500 years later, or 5 years, 5 days later, 5 hours later, hata, no one would take the, you know, file a case from him.
You just seem so contradictory, because on this podcast many times before you've said the speech of a scholar is not a proof, or rather it requires proof. Yeah. And you say this over and over again, the speech of an alim, it doesn't matter who he is. It doesn't, like, and we did tamadhub as well. And we talked about the importance of the Nusus al-Wahyayn and not taking the opinion of any man.
I'm not saying they are proof in and within themselves.
Okay.
I am not. Nor do I claim that. I'm not saying Ibn Abbas, Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Umar, يعني مجاهد سعيد بن جبير الضحاك سدي أبو عالية الرياحي, all of these are proofs in and within themselves. I'm not. What I'm saying is that they say statements and no one's rejecting their statements. When they commented on these verses, I'm saying to anyone who listens, take this point on board. When the Mujahid said, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورَ, زُور here means يعني الغنى, and it's written in the books of tafsir, Durratul Manthur, Ibn al-Suyuti, Jalaluddin al-Suyuti brings it, Qurtubi brings it, Ibn Kathir brings it, Ibn Abi Hatim brings it, Ibn Kathir brings it. And my question here is that these people, when they said these statements, I mean these imams, when they said these statements, why were there no one rejecting and say, look, these ayahs don't mean this?
And we went through ijma as-sukooti as well earlier on in this discussion. And
we went through ijma as-sukooti now.
Okay, I want to move on now, some of the arguments that the people bring for the permissibility of music. They actually say that there are hadith that clearly allow music. The first of them is narrated by Aisha, and we mentioned this earlier about the two slave girls who were singing about besides the Prophet, beside Aisha radiallahu anha, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was also there. And Abu Bakr came and spoke harshly, saying, musical instruments of shaitan near the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam actually turned his face to it and said, leave them alone, let them continue. Isn't this a proof that singing and musical instruments, as Abu Bakr put it, are permissible?
Okay, the first word that was used, can we see that?
Yeah, of course, you can have a look.
So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, what did he say? He said, Mizmar al-Shaytani inda al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Mizmar.
So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she mentioned, she said, دخل على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, she said, Aisha رضي الله عنها, she said, قالت دخل علي رسول الله, the Prophet entered upon me.
قالت, yeah.
She said, قالت دخلت دخل علي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet entered upon me, وعندي جاريتاني, there were two slave girls.
Okay.
تغنياني, they were both singing.
Okay.
So that's the first point, right?
Mm-hmm.
بغناء بعاثة, they were singing the songs of Bu'atha. We're going to come to what that means. Then we've got Abu Bakr seeing this happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Prophet didn't say anything. He was there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَضَّجَعَ عَلَى الْفِرَاشِ وَحَوَّلَ وَجَهُ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was sitting on his, yani lying down on his bed, and he turned his face. وَدَخَلَ أَبُو بَكْرِ, Abu Bakr entered. فَانْتَهَرَانِ, he warned me against it. He prohibited me from it. And look what he said. وَقَالَ مِزْمَارُ الشَّيْطَانِ عِنْدَ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ.
Yep.
The first point I want to go through is that the word mizmar that Abu Bakr here used doesn't always mean musical instruments. I think the English translation here should be looked into. The word mizmar can be the voice. As I mentioned before, لَقَدْ أُوْتِيْتَ مِزْمَارًا مِنْ مَزَامِيرِ آلِ دَاوُدْ حَدِثِ صَحِحِينَ, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, you have been given mizmaran min mazamiri Ali Dawood. And what? Here, mizmar here means husn al-sawt. You've got very beautiful voice.
And we know that because he was reciting Qur'an at the time.
Of course, he's not singing. Okay. Not only that, just imams. Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, when he came to mizmaran min mazamiri Ali Dawood, he said, al-muradu min al-mizmari huna sawtul hasan. Okay. Now he says this, rahimahullah, you can look at the sharh Sahih Muslim. Iraqi طرح التثريب, he says the same thing. He says, والمراد بالمزمار هنا, he says, الصوت الحسن.
So, but we still have a situation where...
We're not going to come to it. Hafiz ibn Hajar, he says, والمراد بالمزمار الصوت الحسن. So, that's important that we understand it. Also, the hadith itself, it mentions what Aisha said at the beginning. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, تغنياني, they were singing. So now I've clarified to you the word mizmar here is not a musical instrument.
Okay, fine.
تغنياني means they were?
Singing.
They were singing. So now we have to go back to what were they saying? Because I remember I categorized the singing for you into two.
Yeah, you did.
This one falls under the first category of singing.
Okay, but and you, Ustad Abdulrahman, in the 21st century knows that. Yeah, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the one, the most
maybe noble, he didn't know the hukum.
He didn't know the hukum, but you do?
No, but I'm saying to you, he didn't know. He didn't know the hukum of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and yet the ruling hasn't come that it's mubah.
The ruling hasn't come yet.
Maybe it wasn't, the Prophet didn't prohibit it yet. The ayats didn't come down regarding music or singing. Obviously, we know alcohol was drunk at the beginning of Islam. Alcohol was drunk by the companions.
Why did he say musical or mizmar shaitan if the ruling hadn't come? Of course, the ruling came.
If the ruling came, the ruling I'm referring to here is that the type that's permissible. He didn't know that.
When did that ruling come? Like, I don't understand.
Look at the hadith itself. Abu Bakr radiallahu, first of all, this hadith also scholars use it against you, which is the Prophet did not say to Abu Bakr, who gave you the right to call it if we say music and instrument?
Him by saying leave them alone is just show it's permissible. Like,
no. The Prophet told them leave them alone.
He didn't have to.
No, but look, he used the word here. He used the, if you say the mizmar here means musical instrument. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, Abu Bakr said, a satanic musical instrument. Okay. Why did the Prophet say that? Why did you refer to?
Because you're assuming that at the time the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam believed that musical instruments were haram. If you take that presumption up, which is what the other side, you're presuming based on that, like you're saying, why didn't he say these are not musical instruments, Abu Bakr?
The Sahabas, the Prophet would correct them in the statements they say. Do you agree with me on that?
Yeah, I agree with you on that.
The action, forget it. Because the action the Prophet is stopping him from is the fact that he's stopping his daughter from it.
Okay.
Because Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, Fantaharani, he stopped me.
So I agree with you that he'd correct them on the wording. It's no problem. I don't understand how you're using that as a proof.
The fact that he called it the shaitan.
Yeah.
He called the musical instrument shaitan.
Mm.
That means that the musical instrument shaitan.
Mm.
That's not a good thing. The Prophet didn't correct him and say, no, music is fine. Why are you calling it shaitan?
I don't know, things weak, but I'm saying just leave them, let them carry on. It's clear that it's not for
shaitan. I'm saying there's two things that happened here. There's two things that happened. Abu Bakr stopping his daughter, he was told off for that.
Yeah.
And the usage of the word, amizmar al-shaytan عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Calling him mizmar shaitan, that wasn't corrected from the Prophet. That's something you should look into.
Okay.
The next point I want to go into is that this first of all, it falls under the ghina al-mubah that we were talking about. Because Ahmad ibn Hanbal, a great imam, Muhammad Ja'far ibn Muhammad, and he said, I said to Abi Abdullah, يعني Ahmad ibn Hanbal, I said to him, عن عائشة جواري يغنين أيش هذا الغنى. Honey, what is this singing that they were singing? What is it? He said, غناء الراكبي. أتيناكم. They were just singing. No musical instrument was used. Khalal narrated that in his kitab, Al-Amru Bil-Ma'ruf wa Nahy 'anil Munkar. Ibn al-Jawzi narrated that in his Talbis Iblis. Ibn Athir, he's an imam in the Arabic language. And what he does is that he takes the words that are strange, the words that need clarification. It's called Al-Nihayat Fi Gharib Al-Hadith. He takes that word, and what does he do? He takes the word and he defines it, explains it to you. If it's in a hadith, he will mention it, he'll expand on it. It's a very good book. Dar ibn al-Jawzi done the taba'a of it with the tahqiq of Sheikh Ali Hassan Halabi. Ibn Athir, he said, in Nihaya, he said, when he came to the hadith, he said, Tunshidani al-Ash'ara. They were only saying poetry. Allati qilat yawma bu'athin. That was said of the day of Bu'atha. That's what he said. And Aisha, at the ending of the hadith, if you look at it, she mentions, Laysatha mughanniyataini. They were not singers. She affirmed the singing and negated another singing.
Mm.
The singing that was affirmed here was what? The singing that was affirmed is that she was
The first type of singing,
which is the one we said is permissible.
Okay.
And the second one that she's prohibiting is that they were not known singers. Ibn Hajar, when it came to Hadith Bukhari, he says, explaining this issue, he said, Al-ghina yutlaqu ala raf'i s-sawt. They raise their voices. And then he mentions, wa ala tarannumi wa ala al-hidai. Wala yusama fa'iluhu mughanniyan. The person who is doing that is not called a singer. وإنما يسمى بذلك من يرشد بتمطيط وتكسير وتهييج وتشويق فيما فيه تعريض للفواحش والتسرع. قاضي عياد said the same thing. But important in his dibaj, Suyuti mentions it as is in the dibaj of Suyuti. Suyuti brought the statement of القاضي عياد اليحسبي. Also Suyuti says in زهر الربا مناوي إن حاشية المجتبى ابن عبد البر. ابن عبد البر his كلام وهذا الباب من الغنى الذي أجازه العلماء he says. ووردت الآثار عن السلف بإجازته وهو يسمى غناء الركبان. That's what Ahmed said. وغناء النصب والحداء هذه الأوجه من الغناء لا خلاف في جوازها بين العلماء. There's no dispute amongst the scholars in the permissibility of this type.
Okay, there's another hadith that the people tend to bring, which is narrated by Ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما, who said that he heard a pipe. It's translated, you can have a look at the Arabic. A pipe, and he put his fingers in his ears.
Who did that?
Ibn Umar
radiallahu ta'ala anhuma.
And he was with Nafi',
sahih.
And he said that he went away from the road and he asked Nafi' radiallahu anhu, are you listening to anything? Are sahih. You still hearing anything? Sahih. He said no. He said he then took the fingers out, and obviously at the time there was some kind of singing, sahih. Or music or whatever you want to call it. Singing was happening. And he said, I was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he heard like this and he did like this. Now the question here is that if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was with Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, and there was singing or music going on, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam put his fingers in his ears, he didn't want to hear it, but he never told Ibn Umar to do the same, how would the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam allow Ibn Umar to do something haram when his job is to correct the companions and to remove them from haram?
This is a very good point, mashallah. But these points, you know, it's always repeated. Wallahi, that's the thing. These people, if it gets responded to, they can bring it again. If it gets responded to, they bring it again. So I hope, inshallah ta'ala, the answer that's given here really sinks in for people.
Go ahead.
There's a difference between sami'a and istama'a. Sami'a means you heard and you listened. No one's blamed ever for hearing something. He's blamed for listening to something.
Okay.
Ibn Taymiyyah pointed this out. Abdullah ibn Umar did the best of what should be done. The best of what was done is that if you hear it, hata put your finger. But we don't say to a person who's on a car and music is playing, but he doesn't listen to it. It's played, he can hear it, but he's not listening to it, he's not a sinner.
So you go into the supermarket, they're just playing music in the background.
No.
And you're not intentionally listening to it, it's just there. It's not a sin.
No. There's a fatwa legend that Imam passed the fatwa. Ibn Taymiyyah before that said this.
So you don't, okay.
So this issue is hearing it. So you have to prove to me that Nafi was listening to the music. He just put his finger in, and then after he asked him, is it on? Nafi said, let me hear it now. Yeah, it's gone now. Do you see my point?
Yeah. So it's
same with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. His sahabas were not listening to the music. They could hear it if they were asked. It's like me saying, Akhi, can you hear that music?
Mm.
And you're like, yeah, I can hear it. Because I've now told you. But all that time it was on.
I didn't even notice it.
You didn't notice it. But when I ask you, you go and you listen. Yeah, it's on. وَهَكَذَا. So this hadith is not a proof for someone to listen to music. Okay. The most that it can be said is that someone is in a place where music is playing.
Okay.
And is, you know, he's not listening to the music. It's a, you know, and he's walking by somewhere. And if some two people are insulting each other, do I have to put my finger in my... Someone's used, two people are using the F word and this and that, they're arguing with each other. Do I have to put my finger in my fingers in my ear? It's best to avoid anything going into your heart and mind.
It's from
wara and taqwa. Lakin, it doesn't mean you have to do that. Same. If you're walking, every time you hear music, you don't put your finger, you don't have to, it's not a must. Because you're not listening. If you're listening, yes.
There's probably a proof that on the other side, on your side, that why the Prophet doesn't even do this in the first place if music was completely fine.
Sahih. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Okay, fine. The next one, and I think this is the final one, is the Hadith of Buraydah, where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam came back from an expedition, and a slave girl said to him, O Messenger of Allah, I took an oath that if Allah returned you safely, I would beat the duff for you and sing. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, if you have taken an oath, then beat it, and if you have not, then do not.
Again, we mentioned this is the type, the duff is permissible for the women, for number one. It's something that's legislated, Alhamdulillah, you've proven that. And also, qudum, somebody coming, we mentioned it from the ghina, which is mubah. And someone can sing for someone who's coming. And This is the first type of singing
that we already discussed.
We mentioned.
Okay, I don't think there's anything else that I have on my sheet to bring. I think the only other one is you've already mentioned that the word mizmar does not necessarily mean musical instruments, because there's another hadith where you've mentioned it a couple of times already, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was listening to Abu Musa recite the Quran, and he said, "This man has been given the mizmar of the family of Ali Dawood," basically.
Sahih.
And that obviously doesn't say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was glorifying music, like some people claim. Sahih. Rather, mizmar just means the beautiful voice.
Yeah, and akhi, to be honest, 30 scholars min a'immat al-Islam, they transmitted an ijma on this issue. That music is prohibited. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, al-Imam al-Awza'i, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, al-Imam al-Ajurri, ijma'. These people transmitted ijma'. Abu Tayyib al-Tabari, al-Baghawi, Ibn Qudama, Ibn Salah, Ibn Abbas al-Qurtubi, al-Nawawi, Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn al-Qayyim, Ibn Rajab, Ibn Hajar al-Haytami. All these great scholars, they're not saying it's haram. No. They're saying ijma'. You have to understand, this is not difference of opinion, these issues. The second type that we mentioned from singing and the musical instrument are unanimously agreed upon. Like in the women, in situations, it's permissible for them. Women are allowed to have music, yani they're allowed to sing, and they, you know, they're allowed to use the deaf specifically. Nothing else was mentioned for them. The deaf, they're allowed to use it. Like in men are not allowed to. Men are never allowed to use the deaf. In no situation is a man allowed. And that man, مُخَنَّث ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he says, وَأَمَّا غِنَاءُ الرِّجَالِ لِلرِّجَالِ فَلَمْ يَبْلُغْنَا أَنَّهُ كَانَ فِي أَحَدِ الصَّحَابَةِ يَبْقَى غِنَاءُ النِّسَاءِ لِلنِّسَاءِ فِي الْعُرْسِ. That's all that we know, he said. We don't know men doing يعني, deaf for men. ولذلك, this is what the الرَّجُلُ الْمُغَنِّي, the man who sings, is a مُخَنَّث.
It's like transgender, they say, hermaphrodite, transgender, like these kind of terms.
Ibn Taymiyyah says in the 22nd volume, in his Majmu' al-Fatawa, page 154, he says, وَلَمَّا كَانَ الْغِنَاءُ مُقَدِّمَةُ ذَلِكَ وَكَانَ مِنْ عَمَلِ النِّسَاءِ. For the women to sing and to use the deaf. كَانُوا يُسَمُّونَ الرَّجُلَ الْمُغَنِّينَ الْمُخَنَّثِينَ. The men who did that were referred to as what? مُخَنَّث. And today we look up to those people and we say, SubhanAllah, he's a rapper, he's a singer. Man, this guy is good. And we give them so much attention.
Mm-hmm.
Ibn Abidin, he said, اعلم أن التغني للهو أو لجمع الرجال والنساء حرام بلا خلاف. Ibn Abidin, in his Hashiyah, he mentions that. Abu Bakr ibn al-Arabi, in his عارضة الأحوذي, he says, فإن كانت حرة فلا يستمع إليها لأن الأمة ليس وجهها عورة ولا صوتها بخلاف الحرة. Again, even the women, a free woman cannot do it in front of a man. Like in a woman who is what? It's a slave, which the hadith of Jariyatain, because they're not awra, their face and their voices are not awra. So the scholars, they gave an exception to that. Now,
okay, so you've mentioned just now that there are 30 scholars that have transmitted ijma'. And ijma'ah is not, like you said, just my opinion is this, or yes, this is haram. It's actually consensus, which is a proof in the religion, as we've already gone through in this podcast and other podcasts as well. The question is though, however, a lot of people still claim that this is, the strongest opinion might be that it's haram, but there is still a valid difference of opinion. And even across my research that I was doing for this podcast, I came across one kitab in particular, the kitab of Imam Shawkani, Nail al-Awtar, where he listed many people who he claimed, or many ulama, many scholars who he claimed that they saw it to be permissible, they saw music to be permissible. What's your response to this kind of thing?
Okay, it's a mistaken belief, wallahi. I'm talking about ijma'. This ijma' I mentioned of these great scholars is ijma'. 23 of them is actually ijma' qawliyun. They clearly and categorically said ijma'. And the other remaining ones are, yani, you can understand it from their statements and okay, the siyaq and the context. Like, for example, Imam Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz died 100 and what? One. It's not issue that some people make it look like, oh, this is, you guys are just Wahhabis and you guys are just, you know, extremist and you love to push the hardest view. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, yani, they say, and he was one of the most righteous people. Tariq in Islam, if you read it, yani, Imam Adil Haqqan, he mentioned it. And he died 100 and what? 101 Hijriya. We have the likes of Imam Malik, who died 179 Hijriya. We have Imam Shafi'i, who died the year 204 Hijriya. Yani, these are big Imams. We have the likes of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah ta'ala, who clearly and categorically has been narrated from him that he said that it's haram. And then Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, he passed away when the year was 241 Hijriah. We have Zakariya ibn Yahya al-Saji, who died in 307. We have Al-Imam al-Ajurri, who died in 360 Hijriah. We have Abu Layth Nasr ibn Muhammad al-Samarqandi al-Hanafi, who died in 375 Hijriah. We have Abu Abdullah ibn Battat al-Ukburi, who died in 387 Hijriah. We have Al-Qadi Abu Tib al-Tabari, who died in 450 Hijriah. Al-Qadi Abu Ya'la al-Farra al-Hanbali, who died in 458 Hijriah. We have Al-Qadi Abu Bakr al-Shami al-Shafi'i, who died in 488 Hijriah. We have Abu Bakr al-Tartushi, who died in 520 Hijriah. We have Abu al-Husayn ibn al-Qadi Abu Ya'la al-Farra al-Hanbali, who died the year 526 Hijriah. We have Ibn Salah, who died in 643 Hijriah. We have Abu Muhammad Mahmud al-Dashti al-Hanafi, who died in 660 Hijriah. We have Ibn Taymiyyah, who died 728 Hijriah. We have Al-Imam Ibn al-Qayyim, the student of Ibn Taymiyyah, who died in 751 Hijriah. We have Muhammad ibn Muhammad al-Manbaji al-Hanbali, who died in 785 Hijriah. We have Burhanuddin Ibrahim ibn Umar al-Biqa'i, who died in 885 Hijriah. We have Abu al-Muhasin Hibatullah ibn Muhammad al-Nasr al-Khuza'i. His name is Abu al-Muhasin Hibatullah ibn Nasr al-Harrani al-Hanbali. We have also Burhanuddin ibn Abdil Haq al-Harafi. And other than them, all of those great scholars I'm mentioning, every single one of them have transmitted an ijma' in the issue. They didn't just say it's haram, it's not allowed. And ijma'. I don't know if everybody wants to hear their qawl and their statements. Like in this mas'ala, truly and to be honest, some scholars, yes, like Ibn Hazm and Shawkani, great scholars of Islam, yani they may have fallen into a mistake and an error in this matter. You know, maybe they have seen it in a particular way. Like in, for us to come after.
Yeah.
And to see these evidences being established and mentioned and these proofs being quoted and referenced. Yani, and for us to just say, Ibn Hazm said it. Yani, you don't have a way out. Ibn Hazm probably has a yani, hujjah for himself, Yawm al-Qiyamah, because the evidence didn't reach him.
And he was sincere.
And he's great. We hope the best for these great scholars and we think good of them. Like, what's your excuse, Imam Allah Ta'ala, Yawm al-Qiyamah? You're going to say Ibn Hazm said when somebody already told you Allah said.
I see. Yeah, it's a very strong point. So to summarize the discussion, to simplify it to many people who may be watching at home, inshallah, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm going to try and do this off memory. But essentially, you started by dividing the issue of music and singing into three categories. One is a permissible type, which is basically naturally raising your voice. Mm-hmm. It might have a very, very slight melody or tune to it, but it's nothing that's unnatural. And these is used this kind of singing was used at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to boost morale and things like that.
Sure.
The second type is the impermissible type, which is where you go unnaturally trying to make a tone to your voice and put a melody on it. And that even this type is only permissible for women. And even then it's only permissible for women in specific situations like weddings and Eid and things like that.
That's true.
And then we have the third type, which is completely impermissible, which is when people use either the first or the second type, but the permissible or the impermissible, when they use this kind of singing and music in an attempt to get closer to Allah. And it's completely haram, that's impermissible. True. And then to prove that this is the different categories of music and that is haram in the religion of Islam, you brought many different ayat from the Quran, and you haven't brought your understanding of these ayat. You haven't just quoted it for the people and just said, I believe this means this. You've actually quoted companions, tabi'in, these people who are the closest to the revelation, and many of them as well, not just one, many of them. And we actually discussed an issue of ijma' as-sukooti, which is basically when a companion says that this refers to music and nobody else says otherwise, and this happens many companions across many different generations, it becomes an ijma', which is a proof in our religion, just like the Quran and the Sunnah are proof. Mm-hmm. Furthermore, you mentioned the Hadith in Sahih Bukhari, which clearly and categorically states, and we went through in great detail the Senate to prove that it's authentic, and secondly, the Metan, which is the actual text itself, and we proved that this clearly and directly says that music, just like alcohol, silk for men, and zina, is not permissible. And the Prophet actually rebuked and he actually spoke harshly against the people who made it halal, just like somebody may be watching this and thinking that music is halal. And then finally, you brought the ijma'at of many, many, many different scholars. And again, just one of them is a proof in our religion. Mm-hmm. But the fact that there are so many of them across so many generations. And you responded also to some of the questions brought forward from the other side, and you've dismissed them. Is that a fair summary?
That's a fair summary. And I also just want, JazakAllah khairan, you did a good job. Wallahi, I also want to mention people not to read these shubuhat that are brought by people who are not going to give you the answers. Don't. And not every khilaf that comes is given weight. If Ubaidullah ibn al-Hasan al-Ambari, who died in 168 Hijriya, and Ibrahim ibn Sa'd al-Qurashi, who died in 183 Hijriya, and Ibn Hazm al-Zahir, who died in 456 Hijriya, and Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, who died in 505 Hijriya, and Muhammad ibn Tahir al-Qaysarani al-Sufi, who died in 507 Hijriya. Their khilaf, with it, the scholars, they didn't give it consideration. Al-Qadi al-Tib al-Tabari, القاضي الطبري إن كتب الرد على من يحب السماع. He says أجمع علماء الأمصار على كراهة الغنى والمنع منه prohibited. وإنما فارق الجماعة رجلان two men went against the جماعة إبراهيم بن سعد and عبيدullah. مع ذلك he didn't give it. He said إجمع and then he mentioned those two. So not every خلاف or every person who comes and says things. And do we say there's a difference of opinion? There are some scholars on this side and there are some scholars on this side. When we look at the muhaqqiqina min ahli al-ilmi, those scholars I mentioned, all the 20-30 scholars that I have, they didn't give weight to the khilaf of Ibn Hazmin or the khilaf of Abu Hamid al-Ghazali or anyone. They didn't. They just pushed it to the side.
And just to clarify, because I've got a couple of notes here, that when we first talked about the issue of singing and you categorize it in al-ghina and you categorize it in three parts, I did say we're not even talking about musical instruments. We're just talking about singing. Throw on musical instruments. I know it's come up many times in our discussion. Musical instruments takes the same ruling.
It takes the same. It's definitely.
And the same with, because obviously you said at the time in the introduction, singing, as in the act of singing. What about listening to someone singing? It takes the same. We've mentioned it many, many times throughout this podcast.
Definitely.
But I just want to make that absolutely clear.
Also, there's a lie that some people put out there about Imam Shafi'i saying Shafi'i permitted music. And he's, the call of the issue of Ahlul Medina and etc. Al-Qadi Abu Bakr al-Shami al-Shafi'i, who died in 488 Hijriya, he says, وَمَا نُقِلَ عَنِ الْكُرْدِي عَنِ السُّلَمِي أَنَّ شَافِعِيَ نَقَلَ الْإِبَاحَةَ يعني he permitted music عن أهل المدينة from the people of Medina, فهو كذب, it's a lie. لأن الكردي وشيخه نسب إلى الكذب. Because this man, علي الكردي, is a liar. He lies a lot. وكذلك ابن طاهر القيصراني من أن شافعية مر بدار قوم that الإمام شافعي went and passed a group of people وجارية تغنيهم and there's a جارية singing for them. الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى listen to it وهكذا. Even Abu Bakr al-Husni, the author of the kitab, يعني the شرح of the kitab متى بشجاع كفاية الأخيار. He debunked that. He said هذا ابن طاهر خبيث دجال صنف في هذا الشأن كتابا اشتمل على خبائث من الكذب حتى عزم هو مجمع على تحريم إلى أئمة الهدى منهم الشيخ أبو إسحاق الشيرازي والشافعي وغيرهما وتجاسر حتى كذب على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then accept it. So, if you would really want to know these issues, one of the great books that's written in is Madarij al-Salikin. Ighathatul Lahfan fi Masajid al-Shaytan ibn al-Qayyim. He speaks about it nicely there. In Izad al-Ma'ad, he speaks about it even in good points as well. Talbis Iblis by Ibn al-Jawzi. Okay. Also, Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali speaks about it. Like in other books that some people are trying to read, I don't want to mention the books because some people might want to go and see those books. Like avoid those books.
Okay, I want to finish with some closing questions, and I really want to bring this issue to the contemporary, to our modern day situation. So most of my questions are going to be surrounding the questions that people ask generally. You mentioned on the podcast that there's a difference between as-sam' and al-istima', listening and hearing. Some people may be asking, is it permissible to eat at a restaurant, for example, willingly, and there's going to be music on in the background and things like that, like you get in many of the Western countries? Is that okay?
Going there knowing the music is on is different from having to go and you're hungry, you need to go, then no problem. But if the music is on, you shouldn't go there, lashak, you should avoid going to it. Places like malls where people generally love to go and places where music is playing. If you have to, lakin labas, tahurun inshaAllah ta'ala.
Okay. What about giving da'wah through poetry? So we're talking about the permissible side. And I know we covered this before, but just to reiterate, we're talking about the permissible side. So it's not like, the normal just raising your voice. Spoken word, for example, a lot of people call it spoken word. First of all, let's remove da'wah from it. Are you allowed to do spoken word poetry?
spoken word poetry, like break it down for me and the listeners as well.
Like someone is just standing on a stage and they're just reciting a poem that they've written, and the poem rhymes, but there's no melody. It's just...
Yeah, I don't see any problem.
Okay. And so listening to that is okay. But what about someone with the intention, like many people do, giving da'wah through these poems? Now you're doing it something to get closer to Allah.
Yeah, yeah. So that making that your way of da'wah, whenever you want to give da'wah, you poetry, that's not something a person should make their shawl or shagil. And every time your poetry, it's poetry, coming out to do poetry, and that's your way of da'wah. It's best to avoid it. Yani, sometimes the deen was defended by poetry. We can't deny that. Yani, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Hassan ibn Thabit, also, yani, go and yani, with your poetry and speak. وَرُوحُ الْقُدُسِ مَعَكَ. So the deen can be defended, and we memorize some books in poetry form. Yani, nadhms, we read them and stuff like that. But science of the religion is protected through these poetic forms. So, but like in all the time, the person's just da'wah is always like that. It's, don't make it your... But if you do it, no problem here and there.
Someone listening to a cappella, like you have a song, for example, but you take the music out and it's just a rapper, for example, and it's almost like he's talking, but it's a cappella. Is that permissible to listen to?
But how did that person get that tune? They had to have listened to the music.
No, like I'm sure on YouTube people upload a cappella tracks. So they've actually done the editing where they've stripped the music and they just have the voice of the artist, the rapper.
I don't know the a cappellas properly.
Okay, fine, no problem. What if the content of the permissible type of music, the one where it's just raising a voice, permissible type of singing, but the content is anti-Islamic, it's talking about alcohol and drugs. Is that permissible?
No, la shaka, that's haram. Mujma'un ala tahrimi.
Okay, the last one is reciting Qur'an in a melodious tone, like you hear about the maqamat.
Yeah.
The different, like, you know, these...
Yeah, great scholars of Islam prohibited it and spoke about it. The great qurra of our time, Sheikh Ibn Baz, gave fatwa against it.
It goes too much and it goes into the second category.
Yeah, there's reciters who are yani, musical. When you hear the recitation of the Qur'an, is this Qur'an? There's one I heard, he was reading the Qur'an.
Sounds like a song, basically. Okay, last thing then, a summary, if you want to just sum up the discussion today, and if you could say, like, including some, just advice for someone who's listening to music and who's struggling to get off music, for example, and they really want to leave music after listening to this podcast, what kind of advice would you give this person?
Well, the point I mentioned about Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah, what he said in his Talbis Iblis, يَنْبَغِي لِلْعَاقِلْ أَنْ يَنْصَحَ نَفْسَهُ وَإِخْوَانَهُ وَيَحْذَرَ تَلْبِيسَ إِبْلِيسَ فِي إِجْرَاءِ هَذَا الْغِنَى الْمُحَرَّمِ مَجْرَى الْأَقْسَامِ الْمُتَقَدِّمَةِ الَّتِي يُطْلَقُ عَلَيْهِ اسْمُ الْغِنَى فَلَا يَحْمِلُ الْكُلَّ مَحْمَلًا وَاحِدًا فَيَقُولُ قَدْ أَبَاحَهُ فُلَانٌ وَكَرِهَهُ فُلَانٌ. Wallahi, this is the way that shaytan gets to a person, and it's been from the deceptions of shaytan. I found myself personally that many people who've been struggling with sins, who've been falling into zina, they is through music. Music, killing, zina, all of it makes it easy. Specifically, the lyrics they use, it makes it people. Also, this concept of depression and anxieties, it gives you it. A lot of people, they connect themselves to it. I know people who told me that I listen to, when I'm sad, this music. And when I'm happy, I listen to this music. And when I'm reading, I listen to this music. And when I do this, and then what happens to them is when they strip themselves from the music, they're dark. They're feeling hurt and heartbroken. You see?
It's kind of like a drug, and you have withdrawal symptoms when you get off a drug, like you can't function.
You can't function. Also, many muharramat, zina, boyfriend and girlfriend, and it comes through lyrics. Women talking about men talking about women. All of this makes somebody want to go commit zina. And want to have, sexual intercourse with someone that is not halal for them. Because it becomes normal. Like, you heard this lyrics, it was said. And you heard this lyrics, it was said. And this lyrics, it becomes normal to you. Yeah. And you lose them. One of the greatest qualities a person should have, which is shyness, haya.
Become desensitized to it.
How you used to. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us in the hadith, استحيوا من الله حق الحياة. Be shy of Allah the way he deserves to be shy of.
This is actually a good answer to a lot of people who, sorry to interject, a lot of people ask that, what is the harm? Like murdering someone, you're taking someone's life. There's a clear harm there. Is in that even you'll probably give birth to a child who in a family where the dad's going to run away, for example, there's a clear harm there. Music has no harm. You're just in your own house. You're not harming the society. You're not harming the people. But as you mentioned here, there are many, many reasons and many harms that occur from that and what it leads to. That's a good answer for that Shubha.
Yeah, it does. And the hadith I was mentioning, which is that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, istahyu bin Allah haqq al-haya, be shy of Allah the way he deserves to be shy of. And the Sahabas, they said, ya Rasulullah, inna nistahyu min Allah. Alhamdulillah, we are shy of Allah the way he deserves. Then the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, man istahya min Allah haqq al-haya, the one who is shy of Allah the way he deserves to be shy of, falyahfadh al-ra'sa, let him protect his head and everything on it. Your head and everything that's on it. Wal-batna, and the stomach, وَمَا حَوَى, and everything that's in it. And don't eat what is haram. So what's it on your head that you need to protect? Your eyes, your ears, your mouth. All of these you need to protect it. Mm. And the stomach, meaning don't eat one. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَالْبَطْنَ وَمَا حَوَى وَلْيَذْكُرِ الْمَوْتَ وَالْبِلَى, remember death and the day you're going to stand in front of Allah. So why do you want to listen to music when you have the Qur'an? Mm. Wallahi, the Quran, if you لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون. The Quran, you have the book of Allah right in front of you. This Quran came down on the mountain, it crumbled. Not only that, Allahumma barik, you have beautiful reciters who touch your heart, penetrate your heart, the recitation of the Quran when you listen to it. What would, and anyone who has the Quran and has Mahmud Khalil al-Husari and Manshawi, wallahi, I don't, يعني, subhanallah, حقيقةً, Mahmud Khalil al-Husari and Manshawi and these great imams of the Quran, when you have them, why would you ever want to listen to anyone else? Or somebody else? Or why would you want to listen to music, la shak? Also, I know a lot of brothers, wallah, who are very good brothers, very good, shy, good to their parents. They listen to this stuff. They lost everything. They lost their wives, they lost their children, they lost their, you know, the respect they had for their parents, and the good kids they were. I wallahi never saw in my heart life, the course of my life that I've lived, I have not seen, and I don't really generally like these blank statements like this, I haven't seen anything that can destroy a person the way that music can. The reason is because everything comes from it.
Mm.
Zina comes from it, liwat comes from it, alcohol comes from it, murdering comes from it, bad friends come from it, and it's the source of all evil, especially at our time. I always used to ask back in the days, I used to say to them, whenever they come and they complain to me about, I'm trying to, do you listen to music?
Mm.
That was one of my first questions I had on my discussion with them. If he says yes, I'll say, first of all, stop that. Yeah, and you'll pray, you'll fast, you'll be good to your parents, everything. This thing, subhanAllah, you know, these headphones that they put in and they listen to, and it's made people monsters. Young youths that you're seeing, they're in a civilized world, Europe. Yani some of them tell me, wallahi, for 2-3 days I haven't eaten, man. I'm hungry, I haven't eaten for 2-3 days, I'm starving. You look at him, akhi, you know, he's not clean, his nails are dirty, his clothing's, yani, the situation is sad, wallahi. And a lot of it because, and we look at it, be honest, a lot of these brothers, his names are Abdullahi and Ahmed and Khalid and Zainab and Amina and Fatima, they grew up in a house where their moms are, yani, Qur'an was played when they were going to Duxi on Saturday, Sunday, Qur'an classes on Madrasa on Saturday, Sunday. Had a good parents, a good household. Where did they learn about, I'm looking after my ends, my turf, my postcode. What postcode are you talking about? You're from Somali, African skin. Wallahi, it's gharib. Well, it's gharib, gharib jiddan. What postcode do you know? Like, please, just... This is owned by the Queen. It's owned by either the Conservative Party or the Labour Party. This is not your postcode. You're fighting. And then when he moves from that postcode, he moves to another, he's fighting for the other postcode at the other ends.
And it comes from the gangster rap and the hip hop and the things like that. Mm.
Where did he got that from? Another guy in America, who's not a Muslim, who fell off in life, who even the non-Muslims see him to be the lowest of the lowest. These rappers are the lowest of the lowest. Aradil.
Yeah.
And non-Muslims are looking at them like.
But many Muslims actually look up to him and almost idolize him to a certain extent.
And his name is Ahmed. Yani Fatima, her name is. Yani, why are you looking up to a non-Muslim kafir? And not even just kafir, because there are kafir who are educated or learned or anything like that. Why out of all of the things you could have copied the non-Muslims in, if you don't want to listen, you still want to copy the non-Muslims, why are you listening? Why are you watching these ones? Do you understand my point?
Yeah.
It's weird. You know, the people today, sad, but we think civilization is following the non-Muslims in the things that, it doesn't bring honor to Islam. Why would you follow the Muslims in football? Why would you follow the non-Muslims in music? Why would you follow the non-Muslims in clothing? Why would you? All of that is no value. If you really want to follow them in technology and how they do it. Follow them in the worldly progression they've come with. You don't. You're backwards on that. You're following these things. It's gharib, gharib, Allah. فَمَنْ زُوِينَ لَهُ سُوَ عَمَلِي فَرَأَوْ حَسَنَةً. Also, the people who've given you these fatwa that music is allowed, you can sing and do music, remember they're not going to come with you yawm al-qiyamah. You're going to be alone. You're going to be questioned, ya Imam Allah Ta'ala, by yourself. And these people who give this fatwa to the people, I ask them one question. When you came out and you gave this fatwa to the people and you say music is a difference of opinion, one question I have. I don't want to ask you any other question, just one question. Did you feel that the ummah was so backwards for not listening to music that you felt that it was a necessary thing for you to come forward and say to them, music, this is your opinion, listen to it. There's a difference of opinion, listen to it. That's the first question I ask. And the last that I ask, if that's not the case, then there's many other things you could have told the Muslims to do. I conclude there, inshallah ta'ala.
JazakAllah khairan, Ustaz Abdulrahman. I look forward to, inshallah, if Allah grants us life, to see you on the Hot Seat podcast once again. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.